Next, a hearing on autism and childhood vaccinations. A House panel is investigating the possibility that certain immunizations may cause the onset of the mental disorder in young children. Today, House members heard from parents of autistic children, plus doctors and researchers. The hearing is just over 6 hours.
If I can have your attention, please. I know a lot of people have cameras, and I hate to throw a wet blanket on those of you that want to take some pictures, but unless you're a member of the media, I wish you wouldn't take any pictures during the hearing. We'll try to get the people you want to take pictures of together later. But please don't take a bunch of pictures during the meeting, because it will probably disrupt what we're trying to accomplish. Good morning. A quorum being present, the Committee on Government Reform will come to order. I ask unanimous consent that all members and witnesses written opening statements be included in the record and without objection so ordered. I also ask unanimous consent that all articles, exhibits, and extraneous or tabular material referred to be included in the record and without objection so ordered. Now, we will have some members that have opening statements. We will allow those, and if they do not choose to give an opening statement, want to give one, prepare one for the record, that'll be fine as well. This morning we're here to talk about autism. As we learned in our August hearing, the rates of autism have escalated dramatically in the last few years. What used to be considered a rare disorder has become a near epidemic. We received hundreds of letters from parents across the country. In fact, here's some notebooks, and each one of those pages represents a parent who has a problem with autism with their child. They've shared with us their pain and their challenges. My staff tells me that some of them cried when they read some of these letters, and I've got a pretty hard-nosed staff. I don't have to read a letter to experience the kind of heartbreak that are in these letters. I see it in my own family.
Yeah, likewise.
I'm very proud of that picture. The one on the left is my granddaughter, and she almost died after receiving a hepatitis B shot. Within a short period of time, she quit breathing, and they had to rush her to the hospital. My grandson, whom you see there, Christian, with his head on her shoulder, according to the doctors, was going to be about 6'10". We anticipated having him support the family by being an NBA star. But unfortunately, after receiving 9 shots in one day, the MMR and the DPAT shot and the hepatitis B, within a very, very short period of time, he quit speaking, ran around banging his head against the wall, screaming and hollering, waving his hands, and became totally a different child. And we found out that he was autistic. He was born healthy. He was beautiful and tall. He was outgoing and talkative. He enjoyed company and going places. Then he had those shots, and our lives changed, and his life changed. I don't want to read all the things that happened to Christian, because I'm not sure I could make it through it. Unfortunately, what happened to Christian is not a rare isolated event. Shelley Reynolds will testify today. Her organization, Unlocking Autism, will be displaying thousands of pictures of autistic children at the Hear the Silence Autism Rally this Saturday. 47% of the parents who provided these pictures felt their children's autism was linked to the immunizations, almost half. We frequently hear about the children with chronic ear infections and children who became autistic after spiking a fever with their vaccinations. Liz Burt was one of the hundreds of parents who contacted us. Her 5-year-old son, Matthew, has been classified as autistic. He was developing normally. At age 15 months following his MMR vaccine, he began to regress. Since the time of his vaccination, he's had chronic diarrhea. That's a picture of him. Good-looking kid. This is very prevalent, this chronic diarrhea in autistic children. He also didn't sleep on a regular basis for over 3 years. Liz took her son to numerous gastroenterologists. in prominent medical facilities in the United States with no resolution. Finally, this past November, Liz took her son to London to the Royal Free Hospital. A team of medical experts there examined Matthew. They felt that he had a bowel obstruction. To the family, this seemed impossible since he had constant diarrhea. An X-ray indicated that Matthew had a fecal mass in his colon the size of a cantaloupe. After the obstruction was cleared with laxatives, Matthew underwent an endoscopy and colonoscopy. The lesions in Matthew's bowel tested positive for the measles virus. Dr. Andrew Wakefield and Professor John O'Leary will be testifying today. Their research has uncovered a possible connection between inflammatory bowel disorder in children with autism who receive the MMR vaccine and have measles virus in their small intestines. Since coming home from England and being treated for chronic inflammatory bowel disorder, Matthew has finally begun to sleep through the night. I know that's a welcome relief for his family. Unfortunately, Matthew's story is not that unusual in children with autism. Our grandson has a similar problem. Unfortunately, it's important that I make two things very clear today. I, and I believe every member of Congress, am not against vaccinations, and I don't think that every autistic child acquires autism after receiving childhood immunizations. And I think slide three shows a lot of children, I think, that have had autism. Is that correct?
A child before and after shots.
Well, those are pictures of children with before and after shots. However, there's enough evidence emerging of some kind of a connection for some children that we can't close our eyes to it. We have to learn more. Dr. Mary Megson of Richmond, Virginia, will testify about the correlation she has seen in children with autism and attention deficit disorder. She's seen a correlation between vitamin A depletion and immune suppression after receiving the MMR vaccination. There are certainly children who are born with autism. They have what can be called classical autism. There are, however, a growing number of children who develop normally and then acquire autism or atypical autism. There most probably is a genetic component to autism, but genetics is not the only issue. Many children seem to have severe food sensitivities, particularly to gluten and casein, ingredients in the most common foods, dairy and wheat. Many of these children show signs of autism shortly after receiving their immunizations. Some of these children, as we will hear from Gina Smith, have metal toxicities, aluminum and mercury. What is the source of these toxic substances? What we are seeing is not autism at all, but a neuroimmunologic dysfunction. I'm very concerned about the increased number of childhood vaccines. I'm concerned about the ingredients that are put in these vaccines. I'm concerned about the way they're given. We've learned that most of the vaccines our children are given contain mercury, aluminum, and formaldehyde. Last year, the FDA added up the amount of mercury our babies are being given to learn that in the first 6 months of life, they receive more mercury than is considered safe. Now think about that. In the first 6 months of life, the FDA has said that children are receiving more mercury than is considered safe, and most of that's from vaccinations. Why is it that the FDA licenses vaccines that contain neurotoxins like mercury and aluminum? When asked about the increased rates in autism, many will immediately discount that there is even an increase, even though the latest statistics from the Department of Education show increased rates in every single state, and that slide will show you that every state has seen a dramatic increase. Others will say the increase is due to better diagnostic skills. Others will say it's because the diagnostic category was expanded. I want to look at the slide of California there. California has reported a 273% increase in children with autism since 1988. For this increase, 21% of all autistic children in California live in the 29th district, which is Henry Waxman's district, the ranking Democrat on our committee. Florida has reported a 571% increase in autism. Maryland has reported a 513% increase between 1993 and 1998. You can't attribute all of that to better diagnostic skills. In 1999, there are 2,462 children ages 3 to 21 in Indiana diagnosed with autism. That's 1/4 of 1% of all the school children in Indiana, or one out of every 400. 23% of these children live in my district, the 6th District of Indiana. This increase is not just better counting. If we want to find a cure, we must first look to the cause. We must do this now before our health and education systems are bankrupted and before more of our nation's children are locked inside themselves with this disease. Kenneth Curtis, part of Dave's morning show at Oldies 100 FM here in Washington, will set the stage by talking about being the parent of an autistic child. He will be followed by James Smythe of Carmel, Indiana. He will share how, though, through proper looking at autism as an illness and addressing that illness, his son is improving. Scott Bono from North Carolina lives close to one of the finest medical facilities in the world, Duke University. However, he has been unable to find medical experts who properly address his autistic son's needs. He is forced to drive 12 hours every 4 weeks for his son's medical treatments. Dr. William Danker, the father of a 13-year-old daughter with autism and a scientist, will testify about the challenges of finding therapies and treatments that have adequate research. He will also talk about the battles of getting adequate education through the public school system. And I think all of us who have autistic children or grandchildren know the problems that involves. We hear repeatedly that parents are not informed at the time of diagnosis by their school system what educational options an autistic child is entitled to. It's only after hiring lawyers and going through the legal process that many children have access to appropriate educational opportunities. We're learning that the earlier autism is diagnosed and treatments are begun, the better it is for the child. Indiana is fortunate to have the First Steps Early Intervention System, a nationally recognized system that provides early intervention services for children up to 2 years of age. Families are forced to spend huge sums of money out of pocket, even when they have good insurance, because autism is often specifically excluded. And we need to talk to the state legislators around this country to tell them how important it is with the explosion of autism that these benefits be mandated by the states and be covered by the insurance. California passed legislation recently to require insurance companies to cover autism. Parents spend $20,000 to $30,000 a year. What medical care is covered is often done so after extensive struggles with insurance companies. We have a long hearing scheduled today with a broad spectrum of ideas presented. We will have a variety of medical approaches presented. We will hear about secretin, which gained a great deal of media attention in the past year and from which many parents have seen tremendous success. Dr. John Upledger, a former advisor to the Office of Alternative Medicine at the National Institutes of Health, will testify on the use of cranial sacral therapy. He is the director of the Upledger Institute in Palm Beach Gardens, Florida. For more than 25 years, Dr. Upledger has been treating autistic children and helping families through this approach. Cranial sacral therapy is a gentle, powerful form of body work that directly influences the brain and spinal cord. It's used to treat pain, discomfort, or trauma to the head or face, including TMJ dysfunction and headaches. Cranial sacral therapy can also relieve physical and emotional trauma. In addition to his work with autism, Dr. Upledger has achieved dramatic results in treating post-traumatic stress disorder in Vietnam veterans. In addition to medical treatments for the physical symptoms of autism, there are numerous therapies that are needed to help autistic children. Special educational approaches are needed. They can include intensive behavior modification known as ABA, LOVAS, music therapy, speech therapy, auditory integration, and sensory integration, as well as play therapy. We'll hear from both the Centers for Disease Control and Prevention and the National Institutes of Health about ongoing research and future needs. Of particular interest is the Brink Township study that has been evaluating a cluster of autism in Delaware. This hearing will raise more questions than we answer today. We owe it to our children and to our grandchildren to ensure that we're being diligent in looking for the causes of autism. We have to do everything humanly possible to determine if there's something that can be done to unlock our children from the prison that they're enduring as a result of autism. I think that is a top priority. We have to do much more research on the potential connection between vaccines and autism. We cannot stick our heads in the sand and ignore this possibility. If we don't take action now, 10 years from now, it may be too late, not only for this generation of children, but for our taxpayer-funded health and education systems that will collapse or can collapse from trying to care for all of these children. The hearing record will remain open for 2 weeks, and I now yield to my colleague from California, Mr. Waxman, for his opening statement.
Thank you very much, Mr. Chairman. I'm glad we're having this hearing today on autism. We still have many questions about autism. What causes it? What are the safest and most effective treatments? Is there a way to prevent it? How many people in the country suffer from autism? We do know some things about autism. We know that there is a genetic component to autism. There have been some dramatic discoveries recently in the genetics of autism, like the discovery of the fragile X gene and the gene that causes Rett syndrome. We know that autism most likely develops very early during fetal development. And we also know that parents are not to blame for autism. We've come a long way from the time when fathers and mothers were led to believe that they had done something to cause their children's autism, leaving them with needless and destructive guilt. But I also understand that this hearing was called to consider a theory that certain vaccines cause autism. From my discussions with medical experts, scientists, and the autism community, it is clear that this is only a theory. As the American Medical Association concluded recently, quote, scientific data does not support a causal association between vaccination and autism, end quote. I believe we need to increase our efforts to understand the causes of autism. In this search, no possible cause, including vaccines, should be off the table. That's why I'm a co-sponsor of H.R. 3301, which would provide additional funding at NIH for research into what causes autism, how many people suffer from autism, and how best to treat those who have autism. But in this process, we must not get ahead of the science or raise false alarms. At every hearing, this committee has held, touching on childhood immunizations, I have made a point of emphasizing the tremendous public health value of immunization. More Americans have been saved by vaccines than by any other medical intervention. Across the globe, 2.5 million children die every year from childhood diseases. Another 750,000 are crippled by these diseases. But American children are shielded from this death and misery by their vaccinations. During my 25-year career in Congress, my focus has been on improving health care, especially for children. When I was chairman of the Health and Environment Subcommittee of the Commerce Committee from 1979 to 1994, we worked constantly to expand NIH research into childhood diseases. And I have continued to fight for more research, better treatments, and coverage while I have been in the minority. During countless hearings and many legislative battles, I've heard over and over again about the pain of parents whose children suffer from debilitating diseases. So I sympathize with the parents who are here today. I know how painful and how hard it must be for you as a parent to have a child who appear to be developing normally, and then all of a sudden, seemingly out of nowhere, stops communicating and stops developing. We need to do everything we can to give these parents here and other parents around the country answers. There is still much to learn. In medicine, the best answers come from research that can withstand the rigors of the scientific method. These standards have been developed in order to find the truth. If research has been conducted with control groups and the results have been independently validated, then that gives parents meaningful information about what causes a disease or a condition and what the best treatments are. Parents and doctors need the best possible information so that they can make the best possible decisions regarding their children's health. There were lots of experts and groups that are knowledgeable about this issue but were not invited to testify today. These groups include Dr. Lewis Sullivan, former Secretary of Health and Human Services and current president of the Morehouse School of Medicine, Dr. Isabel Rappin from the Albert Einstein College of Medicine, the American Public Health Association, the American Medical Association, and the National Network for Immunization Information. I've been requested by these groups, and at this time I would ask the unanimous consent that all their statements be entered into the record.
Without objection, so ordered.
I thank all the witnesses that are here today for appearing. I know how difficult it is for some to be here, how hard it is to share their pain, and how much they want their testimony to be a way for us to understand that we in the Congress have to do everything we can, consider all theories, get to the truth about autism, what causes it, what we do to treat it, how we can prevent it. I see that as our job today, and I look forward to the testimony and learning from the witnesses that will be here to share their perspectives with us. Thank you, Mr. Chairman.
Thank you, Mr. Waxman. Ms. Morella?
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. I appreciate your effort to hold this important hearing on autism, and I look forward to hearing the testimony of the witnesses. I come today to this hearing with an open mind and ready to listen carefully to the testimony of the witnesses. Autism and its associated behaviors have been estimated to occur in as many as 1 in 500 individuals. Over 500,000 people in the United States today have some form of autism. The estimated prevalence rate of autism now places it as the third most common developmental disability, more commonly occurring than Down syndrome. And Mr. Chairman, in your opening statement, you mentioned that there is a 513% increase in Maryland, my state, between 1993 and 1998. And I noticed that the first witness on our first panel is from Maryland, Mr. Curtis. Unfortunately, there's almost no existing data on causes or links to causes of autism in children. I'm very concerned with the striking statistics. I'm most concerned with the lack of information and the confusion surrounding the issue of vaccines and their relationship to autism. I hope that today we can come closer to discerning what the appropriate steps are for this committee to take and for government to take. I hope to learn from testimony that will make this committee better understand where we need to focus research dollars, be it through vaccines, genetic, environmental factors, and why the question of why is autism 4 times more prevalent in boys than in girls. I hope to get some sense of what further studies are needed so that we can accelerate research of autism. There's no question in my mind that this is an issue of high priority and more studies are needed. And that's why I wrote to our representative, John Porter, who chairs the House Subcommittee on Appropriations for Labor and Health and Human Services, requesting an increase in funding for autism epidemiology research at the National Center for Environmental Health within the Centers for Disease Control and Prevention, an appropriation of $1.5 million for the CDC to expand its epidemiology activities in autism from 2 isolated studies to a more national scope. An increase in funding for autism epidemiology research in fiscal year 2001 will enable CDC to expand monitoring efforts to other parts of the country, and this will allow them to better understand the prevalence of autism spectrum disorders, information that is necessary to eventually discover prevention, treatment, and a cure for autism. I think that the choice of this ribbon with its puzzle pieces as the symbol of autism with the heart in the center is most appropriate. And I yield back, look forward to hearing from the witnesses.
Thank you, Ms. Morella. Is Mr. Kucinich here? Okay. Ms. Chenoweth Hage.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. I can hardly begin to thank you enough for holding this hearing. It's astounding to see all of these people who have come from all over the nation, and I understand, Mr. Chairman, that you have arranged for two overflow rooms, and I noticed the hall was packed when I came in. I rarely ask to make an opening statement, but I am unable to overstate the importance of this particular issue, and I look forward to hearing the testimony from the witnesses today and learning more. Mr. Chairman, oftentimes I focus on the larger issues at hand when I address the committee, but I too am the grandparent of an incredibly handsome autistic child, an incredible boy. I cannot overemphasize how much autism affects education and family cohesiveness in the most loving of families. All of these are irretrievably affected when autism is discovered in your own family. Mr. Chairman, when Timmy was born, neither my daughter nor my son-in-law knew that he was autistic. They didn't have a clue. He was the youngest of four children, so his parents thought they knew what to expect in raising a baby. It was only later that they realized that there was something very different about Timmy. When he was diagnosed with autism, we were all worried and saddened. How would our family deal with this, and how could he be educated, and how could we best provide for his future, and how could? And it went on. We had hundreds, if not thousands, of questions. We were shocked and frightened and worried and relieved to know what it was all at the same time. At the same time, none of us knew what the future held, and the questions kept coming. So that's why I'm so very grateful to you, Mr. Chairman, for your courage and willingness to deal in areas that the Congress usually is not willing to open their minds to. Timmy is now 8 and is now a beautiful young boy that we are all immensely proud of. However, I cannot understate the challenges that our family still faces. Parents are desperate to find an answer to their questions. They want so much for their children to have an integrative and communicative life. Oftentimes they feel at a loss, almost desperate in trying to find answers to their questions. Many of my family's questions still remain, yet day after day we still search for answers, and it's an overriding concern with all of us. While our questions are not all easily answered, even the beginning of the questions, we do somehow manage to look toward a brighter future for Timmy than we ever thought possible after his initial diagnosis. He was a gifted child in a number of areas, particularly music, but we still want to learn how to unlock the full potential of his future. All too often, people will write off such potential, but it's there. We're all sure of it. You can literally look in his eyes and see it. Mr. Chairman, autism is a very strange disorder. When Timmy was diagnosed, we were told that medical science didn't know the cause of it, that we were told that Timmy probably had a 4% chance, 4% chance of leading a normal life depending on his IQ. And they thought autism was probably genetic, but they really just weren't sure. After much research, we discovered his current schooling program, which is based on extensive research done by Dr. Ivor Lovas of California. At first, quite simply, we encountered a vacuum of knowledge when it came to autism, and that shocked me. However, what shocked me even more was learning that the rates of autism have increased over the past several years, and the statistics that you showed today, Mr. Chairman, are incredibly shocking. I continue to be surprised when I discovered that some studies have found preliminary evidence of a link between autism and vaccines, and evidence linking dietary health to autism. Vaccines and dietary health are issues that I've been very interested in for some time now, and I look forward to hearing from the witnesses that will address these links. Mr. Chairman, we understand from the research that was the foundation of Dr. Lovas's program, Ready, Set, Go, that the chances of Timmy leading a normal life rose from 4% to nearly 20%. And this is based on the intensive behavioral intervention program developed after decades of research by Dr. Lovas. And you can imagine the impact this program has had on countless children and their families. Research in this area changes lives, as I am sure research regarding vaccinations and dietary health has changed the lives of numerous others. The astounding results of research into this terrible disorder have changed the lives of many families. And as a result of this research, I am aware of families that have literally upended their lives to move across the country in search of programs like Dr. Lovas's. Mr. Chairman, there are some remarkable programs that have developed over the years with regard to autism. In particular, some amazing advances in educating autistic children. But we still need more answers. Mr. Chairman, again, let me thank both you, the committee, and the hardworking staff on this committee for holding this very critically important hearing. For better or for worse, we must deal with this subject. This committee is taking a very important first step. Thank you, Mr. Chairman.
Thank you very much. Mr. Kucinich.
Thank you very much, Mr. Chairman. I have to first inform you that I have a markup and votes in another committee, so I won't be able to stay. But I did want to come here specifically to support the cause of this hearing and your efforts in this regard. Well, I agree with Mr. Waxman when he says that the history of vaccinations have shown a lot of benefits. It's important for science to take note of the increased reporting with respect to rates of autism in recent years. If we have a higher incidence of autism, this is an appropriate subject for a congressional inquiry. And I think it's also appropriate for us to ask questions not only of the witnesses here today, but of the industry producing these vaccines. Because I'm particularly interested in, what are the production protocols for the vaccines which our children get? How are the vaccines being made? What's in the vaccines? Are there any differences in what the vaccines, how they were made years ago and how they're made today? Are there any different products in there? I mean, these are questions that could lend themselves to an understanding of why there's an increased rate today, and it seems to be different than what it was years ago. So I think that when you see the heartfelt concern which is expressed here, the witnesses who are appearing and scheduled to appear, when you see that there are scientists who are willing to address the question of a causal link between autism and a vaccine, and when you have a scientist who's ready to say, well, maybe there's not a causal link, the fact that this debate has begun here suggests an important moment in this Congress and in this country on the issue of autism. We need to find out if there's a link. And if there's a link, we need to find out and go right back to the way the vaccine is made and what it's made of. Because the problem may not be in our children. The problem may be in what our children are being given. So I thank you very much for your diligence, Mr. Chairman, and for your commitment, and for your quality of heart on issues of public health importance. Thank you.
Thank you, Mr. Kucinich, and I want to thank you for all the help you've given us on a whole host of issues relating to the health of the people of this country.
You know, I want to say, I mean, I wouldn't be on this committee if it wasn't for Mr. Waxman's inviting me to be on this committee, and I'm on this because of my deep respect for Mr. Waxman, who I revere as our, not just our leader, but for me, he's been a personal hero. But I think I'm on a committee with two of the best people in the House, so I'm pretty fortunate. Thanks.
I hope everybody heard that. That's from the other side of the aisle. Mr. Osi said he doesn't have an opening statement. Do you have an opening statement? Okay, we will now proceed with our witnesses. As a practice, especially since we're talking about something as important as the various problems that have been occurring with you folks with autistic children. I'd like to have everybody rise. We now have our first panel, Mr. Kenneth Curtis, James Smythe, Shelley Reynolds, Gina Smith, Scott Bono, and Dr. Wayne Danker. Would you all raise your right hand, please? Do you solemnly swear to tell the whole truth and nothing but the truth, so help you God?
I do.
Seated. Mr. Curtis, would you like to start? And what I'd like to ask, because we have 19 witnesses, and this is a very big hearing we're having today, could you try to confine your remarks to 5 minutes? Some of the doctors who have some technical expertise that they want to express will allow them a little latitude. But if you could stick close to 5 minutes, we'd really appreciate that. So, Mr. Curtis, would you like to start?
Certainly. Mr. Chairman, all of you, thank you, first of all, for this opportunity to speak on behalf of my son.
Would you pull the mic a little bit closer? The mics don't pick up as well as we'd
like. Sure.
Like.
Leave it to the radio guy to mess up the microphone. Thank you again for this opportunity to speak on behalf of my son, my family, and children with autism nationwide. But mostly, I'm speaking on behalf of my son because this is really his story. Autism doesn't announce itself in the delivery room. When our son Morgan Scott was born, he looked like a Shar-Pei dog. He was wrinkled from head to toe, and things were sort of storybook for us at that time. We had a girl and a boy and a mom and a dad, and life was kind of like a picnic, but the clouds were rolling in, as it were. Slowly, little drops of doubt began to fall. We wondered about the way he liked to watch Disney videos over and over, or how he would spin around and make strange noises and look at things out of the corner of his eye, the way he liked to line up his toys. Drop after drop, we wondered and we waited to see what would happen. He didn't talk, and most of the time he didn't even seem to hear us, so we worried some more and we wondered until all these little drops were like a downpour, and of course we had to take cover. Our doctor suggested a hearing test, but his ears were fine, he just wouldn't talk. So we tried speech therapy, but he still wouldn't talk. And even with all these odd behaviors, my son was a happy enough kid. I mean, he was loving, affectionate, he was ticklish, stubborn, just like any kid, but he wouldn't talk. Finally, when Morgan was a little more than 2 years old, we had a word for it. And the word was more terrifying and confusing than any of the things that we were dealing with at the time. Of course, the word was autism, but what did that mean? Of course, we thought of Rain Man, but we also thought of all the horrible stories you hear about the kids who repeatedly bang their heads against walls or bite and scratch and sit rocking, hugging themselves in the corner. Is it possible that this could be our little boy? I mean, it didn't seem real, but obviously it was. Morgan was diagnosed as moderately autistic, a term I've always thought to be a bit like being moderately pregnant. So we began to immerse ourselves in information. We were determined to learn everything possible about autism. And when I say we, I really mean my wife, Kimberly. You have never seen a woman on a mission until you've seen a mother determined to save her child. There's no match for a mother's love. She read, she researched, she investigated, while I tried to come to terms with the idea that I might never be able to shoot hoops with my son. Before long, we had a plan. We opted for the one-to-one intensive ABA therapy program developed by Dr. Lovas at UCLA. We spent thousands of dollars, wrangled with the school system, hired lawyers, lived in my grandmother's house to save on rent, and we began teaching our son in-home. For 5 years, Morgan had between 30 and 40 hours a week of one-on-one therapy. At age 4, my son had more college friends than most fraternity brothers. He learned to read a little, to spell a little, to use the toilet, and most importantly, he learned how to listen to people, and he even began to talk a little bit. I'm a radio guy. I talk for a living, and the irony of having a son who doesn't know how to communicate with words is not lost on me. I know there are things that my son wants to say to me. And as he gets older, I can look into his eyes, and I can see the frustration and the confusion. There's a little boy inside of him somewhere, but it's like he's lost, and this is really what it's like. It's like being in the mall with your child, and you look down and you discover they're not there anymore. It's that sickening feeling you get in the pit of your stomach. Excuse me. Except every once in a while, you catch a glimpse of the real boy. You know, the way his eyes light up when you bring the Christmas tree home. Or the way he smiles when he jumps into the pool, or the way he sits perfectly still and raptured when we go to see the symphony. He loves music, he loves animals, he loves trains, he loves books, swings, ice cream.
Even his family, of course. But he can't tell me his favorite color, or how his day at school was, or what hurts when he falls off the swing set. He still hasn't figured out how to express or reveal himself. And it doesn't seem like he understands why this is so important to us. I want to know why my son is locked inside of himself. Is there a genetic disposition? Is it environmental? Is it something in the water? Do pesticides cause it? Preservatives, antibiotics, immunizations, NutraSweet, the time he fell and hit his head? Sounds crazy, but these are the things we've all heard and thought about. And the truth is, we have no idea why our son is autistic, and we have to accept that. But we love our son so much that you can never give up hope that he'll one day carry on a conversation with us, or even just say, "Hi, Dad," when I come home from work. Morgan is a truly beautiful person in his own right, just as he is right now. I have never met anyone, and I doubt I ever will, who lives more in the moment than my son. He is affectionate, he's imaginative, even humorous sometimes. And I've learned more from him than I have from any other single person in my entire life. He is autistic. And that's just the way he is. But not everybody is as lucky as we are. Morgan isn't aggressive or self-injurious like a lot of individuals with autism. He's 8 years old. I've had a lot of time to come to terms with this. And even so, the frustration of dealing with autism is nearly eclipsed by the frustration at the lack of concrete information about this disorder. Autism used to be considered rare, the kind of thing you read about, oh, thank you, or see in movies, but never actually happened to anybody you knew. In January of this year, the ASA estimated that autism has increased from 15 out of every 10,000 individuals to 1 in 500. And the repercussions of this increase are so far-reaching. These children will need specialized education and appropriate care for the rest of their lives. Are we honestly ready for this? Are our schools equipped to handle this increase? This overwhelming surge in this disorder is not going to just affect individual families. This is going to impact our community and the entire world in which we live. My son is a beautifully colored thread in the fabric of my family. But even so, one in every 500 families shouldn't have to live with this disorder. And what if these numbers keep increasing? So, here I am today, wearing the only suit that I own, discussing my son before the legislative arm of the ruling body of the greatest nation in the world. And believe me, testifying here today is one of the most important things I've ever done. And with all due respect to the tremendous body of work before each of you, I'd like to think that it's a very important day for you as well. Thank you.
Thank you very much, Mr. Curtis. Mr. Smythe.
Thank you very much, Congressman Burton, Congressman Waxman, and other members of Congress. Thank you very much for the opportunity to speak here for my son and for the tens of thousands of autistic children around this country and the millions of people that are affected by this, literally. Parents, brothers and sisters, aunts and uncles, grandparents, etc. I will keep my remarks to 5 minutes, but I'd like to make 2 points here, and actually 3 points, and I'd like you to write these down. First is, living with these children can be hell. They can destroy your entire home. You can't keep anything nice around. They will ruin your rugs. They will jump off the furniture. They will move the furniture around the room, push it over, break things, clear counters with one sweep of the arm, and they do nothing with any intention of no malice whatsoever. And one cannot take them to friends' homes. One cannot stay overnight at friends' homes. One is at a friend's home or a relative's home. They will be worse there because it's a strange environment. The second point is that no one, to my knowledge, is measuring consistently. No one is measuring acquired autism. And Congressman Waxman, you mentioned that there's no causal connection between autism and vaccines. That there's no measurable causal connection.
I said that there's a theory, and that theory still is controversial.
Is unproven. And I would suggest to you that we are now defining autism as behaviorally, that certain activity, certain behavior on the part of these children makes them be classified as autistic. And then most of the medical community gives up. and that there is a difference between classical autism, Kanner autism, a child that is born autistic, that one knows is autistic, that most doctors have been trained about as autistic because that is the way they were born, and they show up that way. And this late onset autism that we're seeing, this acquired autism, if you will, there's a tremendous difference, and there may be many different medical causes. But because in our language we are not making that distinction, we are not able to follow medical cures or even medical causation. So that's an important distinction, I think, that needs to be made for all of us and by the NIH. And if you look with the insurance companies, if a child is labeled autistic, they will not cover it. It doesn't matter what the cause is of that behavior. If you look at the educational models, if you speak to the professionals that are up here, they do not have a distinction, to my knowledge, in the way that children that are acquired autistic are trained compared to children that are classically autistic. How are they educated? And the end result is that our educational models are not recognizing that some of these children may, in fact, just simply be sick. They may just simply be diseased. And as a result, we're letting them down, and they are going through the educational system basically being warehoused without any treatment, either medically or educationally. From a financial standpoint, the stresses are huge. When one has an autistic child, suddenly a whole new world potential trauma has opened up. There's very little known in the subject with regard to treatment. And we have followed a number of different treatment programs: auditory integration therapy, vision therapy, speech therapy, occupational therapy, sensory integration therapy. We've participated in swimming and horseback riding, had CAT scans and allergy testing and stool analysis and urine analysis and all kinds of blood analysis. And what we've noticed is that there is often kind of an uncaring attitude by providers of many of these services. Well, maybe we'll find out what's going on. Their house is not being destroyed. They do not have the motivation, the drive, it seems, to research this process. But it's very important to research. Our school system is so overwhelmed that a recent Indianapolis Star article said that anyone with a college, the state of Indiana has now changed the rules so that a special education teacher can include anyone who has a college degree. Now, what kind of special education is that? There is such a need out there, and the burdens are only going to become that much greater. The waiting list for Indiana's Medicaid waiver, in order for a parent to get some financial assistance here, is 3 years. And as I understand, it's growing. It has to grow with the increase in these numbers with these children. The ignorance, in short, is phenomenal. Now, I noticed that Secretary Shalala and the First Lady spoke about the use of Ritalin with children, and I've read that 10 to 20% of children are now on Ritalin. Has it occurred to anyone that there may very well, and almost certainly is, a causal connection that is related between ADD and this increase in autism, that they may be all part of one spectrum? And I suggest that this needs to be looked at. But we have to make distinctions in language in order to do that.
Mr. Smythe, if you could summarize, we'd appreciate it. I know that you have a lot to cover, and we do appreciate your testimony, though.
The bottom line is that there are ways to measure how this autism, what is now showing up as autistic behavior, there are ways to show how at least some of it that seems to be immune-related is affecting the brain differently from most of us, and how it can be treated and then cured, and how the treatment itself can be seen to produce results in return of blood flow to the brain. And I sincerely request that the members of this panel, that the National Institute of Mental Health, and that the Secretary of Health Education, Health and Education, look very carefully into this process and support the healing of these children, at least the subset probably responsible for this large increase. Thank you very much.
Thank you, Mr. Smythe. And could we get copies of those documents that you just... Do we have those? We do have those. Thank you very much. Appreciate you being here.
Thank you.
Ms. Reynolds?
Mr. Chairman and members, my name is Shelley Reynolds. I live in Baton Rouge, Louisiana with Aiden, my husband of 8 years, and my children Liam, who is 4, and Marin, who is 2. I would like to thank you both for holding this hearing and allowing me to testify before you today. I met Aiden in the 10th grade. We were in love with each other from day one. We dated all through college and we got married as soon as we graduated. We had our own house and we had 2 cars and 2 careers and 2 dogs. We were living the American dream. Right after we were married, Hurricane Andrew, one of the most destructive hurricanes to ever hit the United States, slammed through Baton Rouge. Sustained winds of 100 miles an hour ripped up our roof, and 8 days without electricity left us with very little food or water. We promised each other we would never again be unprepared for such a disaster. But 6 years later, hurricane force winds blew into our home again, and this time the disaster was the diagnosis of autism for our firstborn son, Liam. It completely tore our home apart, and the effects have lasted much longer than 8 days. No amount of preparedness can ready you for a storm such as this. Liam was a normally developing baby until June 27, 1997, when he received his MMR and HIB vaccines. He did everything he was supposed to do. He cooed, rolled over, crept, crawled, pulled up, and walked right on time. He said, Mama, he said, Daddy, he said, love you. He learned how to sing the Itsy Bitsy Spider. He played finger games with us. He loved to interact, and he especially loved to show off for his grandparents. We did all the well baby checkups. They were all kept on time. I breastfed him until he was 8 months old. I didn't start solid foods until he was 4 months old. We did everything completely by the book. But when he was 17 months old, shortly after he had received the shots, he started exhibiting some different behaviors. He was constantly taking off his shoes. He screamed if we dressed or undressed him. He would stare for hours in front of a television and wouldn't move if you blocked the view. He couldn't tolerate playing in the sandbox anymore. He didn't want to sing any of his favorite songs. He would cover his ears and just scream no. We assumed he was just asserting his independence since he was almost 2. And somewhere along the way, he developed chronic, nonspecific diarrhea, sometimes 8 to 10 times a day, and still suffers from that 3 years later. By April of 98, I realized Liam was no longer saying mama or daddy or love you, so I took him for a speech and language evaluation, and they told me that my 27-month-old child had the language capacity of an 8-month-old. This was a child that only months before would chime in E-I-E-I-O at the appropriate moment when singing Old MacDonald. What had happened to our beautiful baby boy, and how could we help him? My husband and I decided to become advocates and work for increased funding for autism research and for awareness. The answers may not come in time to help our son, but we're hopeful that we can persuade you to see the need for intensive research regarding this disorder, which is affecting more and more children every year. In Liam's case, we have no doubt that he developed his autism as a direct result of an adverse vaccine reaction. And personally, if I could strike the belief that my son's autism sprang from a routine childhood vaccination that I held him down on the table for and had to go back to the Russian roulette of genetics, I would take it in a heartbeat. Because the pain knowing that I inadvertently caused him harm due to the blind trust in the medical community or a matter of inconvenience of yet another office visit taking time away from my job is nearly unbearable. Many in the medical community continue to dismiss this as mere happenstance because autism often coincides with the time of vaccination and state that there is no scientific evidence to back this up. My question to you is, how long does it take for a coincidence to surface time and time and time again, case after case after case, before it can become a viable hypothesis, especially when the solution to solving the problem seems so apparent? How can pharmaceutical companies concoct substances with mercury, formaldehyde, antifreeze, lead, aluminum, aborted fetal tissue, and live viruses, and not expect that as they continue to pour these highly toxic and reactive substances into children, increasing dose after dose all on the same day, that it won't alter their minds and bodies? Why would it be so completely impossible for a child to contract a chronic form of the disease rather than to have the quote-unquote proper immunological response, especially if their immune systems aren't up to par? And where is their scientific evidence to back up the claim that this cannot happen when it's published in the very package inserts in their writing that they have not studied the effects of these vaccines for more than a few weeks or longer than the incubation period of the disease itself? Or what happens when you give multiple doses in one day or combine different diseases into one hypodermic needle. And I need someone to explain to me why it's acceptable to have products on the market that expose my son to 37.5 micrograms of mercury in one day at a time when he should not have been exposed to more than 0.59 micrograms of mercury given his body weight. I shouldn't be exposed to more than 5 micrograms. And I have 31 years of an immune history behind me. It's completely unacceptable. One size does not fit all when it comes to vaccines. Through our organization, Unlocking Autism, we have talked to thousands and thousands of parents from across the country, and their story is the same. Child is normal, child gets vaccine, child disappears within days or weeks into the abyss of autism. And if you doubt me, I invite you to come to the Hear Their Silence rally on April the 8th on the Mall, where the Open Your Eyes Project will be displayed, and view the thousands of pictures that we've collected and realize that 47% of those people who participated believe that vaccines contributed in some way to the development of their child's autism. Parents like me are relying on you to demand the pharmaceutical companies retrace their steps once again, and that the public health community look at the possibility that these things might indeed not just be a coincidence. They obviously have a forced market. They manufacture products that are required for every child in this country. And we fear that it's possible that while seeking greater monetary profits, there may be some who have lost sight of the medical community's original goal regarding vaccinations to protect them from harm. I know my children, and I know what happened to my son. And as far as I am concerned, the needle that silently slipped into my baby's leg that day became the shot heard around the world. Thank you.
Thank you, Ms. Reynolds. Ms. Smith?
Mr. Chairman and members, I'm Gina Smith. I live in Denham Springs, Louisiana, with my husband, Daryl, and our 4 small children. 5-year-old genetically identical twins, Jesse and Jacob, 3-year-old Garrett, and 16-month-old Juliana. Daryl and I have always loved children, and we tried for over 6 years to have a child. We simply gave up on the idea that it was possible, and then I discovered I was pregnant with not one, but 2 babies. And I was just completely overwhelmed. And our twins, because I had tried so hard to have a child, I took especially good care of my body while I was pregnant with the twins. Our identical twins were born right on time and completely healthy. We were absolutely thrilled. Our family was perfect. 1 month later, we found dark blood mixed in with Jacob's diarrhea. Jacob had never had diarrhea before. We immediately took him to the doctor, who assured us that there was no problem. He mentioned that in the chaos that generally follows the birth of twins, we were released from the hospital without them receiving their hepatitis B vaccine and wanted to give it to Jacob that day. I questioned him because it did not seem right to give a potentially ill child a vaccine, but he convinced me that it was routine and safe and not to worry. 2 months later, Jacob received his second hepatitis B vaccine and Jesse his first. On this same day, Jacob and Jesse both received their first DPT, polio, and Hib vaccination. From that day on, Jacob was constantly coming down with one ear, respiratory, or sinus infection after another. Jacob was constantly on antibiotics. As his mother, I was heartbroken to see him sick or in pain practically all the time. As a new mom, I was embarrassed and frustrated to have a child that was always ill. I knew I was doing everything I could for him, and I could not understand why he was constantly ill. Jacob met every developmental milestone that first year right along with Jesse. They were 2 little peas in a pod that went everywhere together. At only 16 months of age, Jacob and Jesse received their first MMR vaccine. On this same day, they also received their 4th DPT, their 4th Hib, and their 3rd hepatitis B. The following 24 hours, both twins slept most of the time with over 100 degree temperatures, in spite of receiving the recommended Tylenol dosage every 6 hours. Immediately following that, Jacob began exhibiting strange behaviors. He was no longer excited or responsive when Daddy would come home from work. He began to become preoccupied with certain toys. He would spend long periods of time studying the way their wheels would spin or whether or not they were lined up just right. Any attempt to interrupt or distract him was met with great resistance and an eventual fit. During this time, Jesse continued to progress, starting to talk and interact with all the children around him. Back to the doctor we went again, but this time with even bigger concerns about the growing developmental difference between Jesse and Jacob. And once again, we were met with the dominant twin theory that Jacob would probably be more quiet. Jacob would probably want to play by himself more often. Jacob is fine. Stop worrying. Finally, we could not stand the difference between their language communication skills. Something was most definitely wrong with Jacob. He could not express even the most simplest needs or wants. He could not ask for juice or something to eat. Jesse was chattering constantly. And at times, Jacob was so withdrawn, we could absolutely not reach him. On days when Jacob is overloaded from sounds, colors, or lights, we cannot go anywhere. Autism does not only isolate the individual that it affects, it isolates the entire family. My husband and I have to go to the grocery store independently. When our other children have programs at school or birthday parties, one of us has to stay home because Jacob cannot stand the outside stimulation. Our vacations have changed to only being able to go to the beach, no amusement parks, no baseball games, no family outings. Unlike most parents of an autistic child, I don't have to wonder what Jacob would have been like. I know what he would have been like. I see what he would have been like every day in Jesse's eyes. I see Jesse excelling in school and in social activities. I see Jesse excited about t-ball. I know that Jacob will probably never play t-ball and that he cannot attend birthday parties. For us, there is no denying that in Jacob's case of autism, the answer does not lie in genetics, but in a catalyst. The thousands of hours of research that we have spent searching and retracing his regression continues to point to the fact that the road of Jacob's autism began when his immune system was damaged by the hepatitis B vaccine he received when he was ill. The final blow was the adverse reaction to the host of vaccines he received 16 months later. We are certain that for Jacob, the catalyst was his vaccine. I can't bear the thought that after waiting so long and being so careful carrying my twins, I was so easily persuaded to immunize Jacob without knowing all I should have. I should have taken the time to find out what his risk of contracting hepatitis B at only 1 month old was. I didn't do that. I should have found out about all the toxic metals that are used to manufacture the vaccines. I did not do that. I should have known back then what I do today. I did not. I trusted his pediatrician. I trusted the CDC. I was persuaded to believe that I was doing the best thing I could do to protect my child. Every scientist, doctor, researcher, or parent looking for answers or resources should never have to question where their funding will come from. It has to be here, and it has to be here now. I implore you to act now. Please, we do not have the time to wait for another hearing and another panel of parents and experts to advise us that this epidemic is waiting in the wings. We are swiftly and silently losing a generation of children to this disease that possibly could have been avoided. Please let this country be the leader in seeing the percentages of autism decrease and not increase. Every night, Daryl and I tuck two beautiful little boys into bed. On the outside, they look just the same. Their pajamas are the same. Their bed covers are the same. Everything on them is the same. They have the same ears, and they have matching toes. As Daryl and I sit in between their beds, we talk with Jesse about his day. He gives us all the details of his day at school and tells everything he did with his friends. He talks about how excited he is for the next birthday party that will come this weekend. He talks to Daryl about working on his batting swing to prepare for t-ball in the summer. As he drifts off to sleep, we turn and we look at Jacob. We know, even at only 5 years old, Jacob will never be able to enjoy the simple pleasures of childhood the way Jesse does. He will never be on a sporting team. He cannot enjoy the fulfillment of a birthday party or friends. This difference is real. We know Jacob's autism will not go away. When they fall asleep, we once again can see two beautiful matching faces. We know what should have been. It is the only time that their faces match. Even though they are identical, Jacob's countenance left when he was 16 months old. The light behind his eyes was replaced with a blank, lost, bewildered stare. Thank you.
Thank you, Mrs. Smith. Mr. Bono.
Before I get it, before I begin, I'd like to give you a perspective of an autistic parent. Right now, I'm more nervous about where my son is because I don't see him than I am being before you today. That's a constant worry in an autistic parent's mind. My name is Scott Bono. I live in Durham, North Carolina, and with my wife, Laura, and my children, Dylan, Ashley, and Jackson. I read the testimony and heard the stories of other parents in similar circumstances. Change that to identical circumstances. Our story is not much different. We had a perfectly normal pregnancy and birth of our son. In the first 16 months of life, he learned language, played with toys, appropriately began pretending skills, initiated contact with his twin sisters, and could light up a room with his wonderful personality. He was brighter than most, and he could even tell the difference between a Concorde jet and a 727 at such an early age. On August 9th, 1990, Jackson would begin a journey into silence, bewilderment, and a medical enigma. That was the day he received his MMR immunization. He would not sleep that night. In the days to follow, he would develop unexplained rashes and horrible constipation and diarrhea. After eating, he would experience projectile vomiting that would scare him. His normally very healthy body was being ravaged by an invader. Over the next weeks, he'd slip away, unable to listen or speak. He retreated into what we now know as autism. He became allergic to everything in his world. His immune markers skyrocketed. What was the reason for the change? It's my sincerest belief that it was that shot. The single biggest challenge in raising an autistic child is getting appropriate, informed, and competent medical services. As I sit before you today, autism is, as it has been for decades, viewed as a psychological disorder. I can't help but wonder about it and get frustrated by the lack of medical and physiological intervention for all of these children. I live just 3 miles from Duke University Medical Center, yet for one of the most effective treatments for Jackson's gastrointestinal problems, I drive 12 hours for a procedure that takes 5 minutes. I've been doing this for the past 2.5 years and will be making this trip 13 times this year alone. To dismiss Jackson's acidic diarrhea for 7 years because autistic children sometimes do that is just what happened. That's just unacceptable. As my son's advocate, I know he's not receiving the medical treatment he needs. And I believe that as long as autism is regarded as a psychological disorder, this will always be the case. We need and seek responsible, effective, and caring physicians who don't dismiss the patient's ailments as behaviors, but look at them as treatable medical conditions with appropriate medical intervention. This is what I believe to be the single biggest problem in getting group insurers to pay for medical services. Insurers must pay according to their contract. It's the law. But if a doctor says the visit to his office is for the treatment of autism, when the autistic child is being seen for gastrointestinal distress, the insurer won't pay the claim. If, however, the diagnostic code for the visit shows that it's for gastrointestinal distress, the bill will be paid. The diagnosis of autism is used as a shield by some insurers to deflect the responsibility of paying for medical and remedial treatment for these children's medical problems. The expenses to seeing to Jackson's needs are overwhelming, hundreds of thousands of dollars over the past 8 years. After going through all of our savings and retirement, we continue to accumulate debt to meet his educational and therapeutic needs and his medical needs. Our priority right now is to get him well, though. There are other costs besides financial. Jackson is on a very strict diet and that takes time and money. If he eats offending foods, he gets a rash, has diarrhea, and we will not sleep for the next 5 nights, and his behaviors will worsen. How do I put a cost on not sleeping for 6 years? How do I put a cost on attention not paid to my daughters because I'm seeing to the needs of my son? How do I put a cost on locking every door and window at all times for fear of him wandering out of the house? Financial burden? It's only part of it. It's only part of the picture that families with autistic children face. If the price of eradicating measles, mumps, rubella, or any other illness is thousands of autistic children or health-impaired children, is it worth it? Have we simply traded acute illness for chronic disease? Is that worth the price? Autism has reached epidemic proportions and the numbers are still growing. We must allocate funds to find the cause and the cure. The U.S. Department of Education indicates the increase in autism is 900% in 8 years since 1992. If tooth decay went up 900%, we'd be scrambling for answers. The statistics can no longer be ignored. Thousands of parents who claim their children were developing normally until the MMR vaccine should no longer be ignored. We all can't be wrong. As elected officials, you hold the public trust, the essence of faith in government. Your challenge is to uphold that trust. Thank you.
Thank you very much, Mr. Bono. Dr. Danker?
Honored committee members, fellow panel.
Would you pull the mic real close to you, Doctor? Those mics don't pick up real well.
It's always tough going last. Honored committee members, fellow panel participants, and members of the audience, I feel privileged today to appear before this committee to share my perspectives on autism, foremost as a parent, but also from the additional perspectives as a pediatric infectious disease specialist and a scientist engaged in clinical research and evidence-based medicine. My daughter, Natalie, who's over there, is now nearly 13 years old, has autism and has taught my family and I a lot about ourselves and how the world around us deals with individuals who appear different from the norm. She's been both a joy and a real challenge to live with, and we continue to live through these experiences every day, and I want to emphasize that. We have weathered this storm by rejoicing in her triumphs and finding the humor in past events, even when those events may have seemed unbearable at that time. And I should add that my wife, unfortunately, is the one who has to bear most of these unpleasant experiences. We've found that our daughter's greatest needs have been in the area of education and for a highly structured environment to allow her some control over the events of her life. It is in the area of education that we've experienced our greatest challenge and been labeled by our local school district administrators as the most difficult parents they have had to deal with. In the context of that meeting, we found this statement both an insult, and there were other personal comments made to my wife that essentially have put her in a position that where she will not talk to the school district administrators any longer. But we've been convinced by our friends and family that we should wear this as a badge of honor. If anything, it highlights the advocacy we have championed for our daughter's rights to an appropriate education that addresses her individual needs and the manner in which she learns best. And I should point out that probably every parent on this panel is their child's best advocate. My greatest hope today is that members of this committee and the audience will gain a better understanding of the unique nature of autism, the challenges and demands placed upon families caring for autistic children and adults, the significant emotional, financial, and community resources required to prepare and involve these individuals in everyday life, and to accept and respect these individuals for who they are. However, as previously mentioned, I also come to this committee as a trained infectious disease specialist and clinical scientist, and therefore feel compelled to comment on two other areas of importance to me. In the area of medical and other treatments intended to help autistic children function to the best of their ability, I would hope to see more funding to allow for appropriately controlled and conducted studies to rapidly determine the true effectiveness of these interventions so that families can make informed decisions regarding the best use of their limited resources, as we've heard from a number of the panel participants already. Without these studies, I and other parents of autistic children are forced to make decisions which may at times prove disadvantageous to all involved without the benefits of real data. I would also wish to comment on the current concerns regarding the potential causes for the perceived increase in autism. I implore the committee to be cautious in its statements and conclusions with regard to possible links to environmental factors and medical factors, especially immunizations. Recognizing there are other parents in this panel who may feel otherwise, in fact, definitively feel otherwise, as a pediatric infectious disease specialist, I have seen no sound evidence linking autism to the MMR or any other vaccine, yet there is considerable evidence proving that the MMR vaccine is safe and highly effective in protecting children from serious diseases. In closure, no matter what conclusions are formed today or where the activities of these hearings may lead, I would like to share an axiom in medicine I have both learned, practiced daily, and continue to teach to future doctors. Above all, do no harm. Thank you.
Thank you, Dr. Danker. First of all, let me, I'll start with you. Your daughter, who's a lovely young lady, I see her sitting over there. Your daughter acquired her autistic condition. Was this from birth?
No, she had the typical description that has been more commonly described of showing some behaviors that became more and more obvious as she reached into from about 14 months to about 18 months of age.
When she was 14 months or thereabouts, did she receive any shots?
She received the normal vaccine schedule of immunizations as recommended by the American Academy of Pediatrics and the
ACIP. What shots were those?
She received her MMR at about 15 and a half months of age.
And when did she manifest her change?
She was manifesting subtle changes before that. That was obvious to us. We just didn't know what to attribute it to at that time or what the issues were. We used to joke that compared to our older son, she seemed to be on an independent study program.
Did she receive any other shots before she started seeing the when you started seeing the manifestations of autism?
She had received her previous shots at about 6 months of age.
And had she received any others close to the time she started developing autism?
Not at that time, no.
No, there were no other shots?
No, because at 12 months, essentially, you just get your PPD to screen for tuberculosis, which in California is potentially prevalent.
When she started manifesting these signs, did she get worse after the MMR shot, or did it have any effect at all? Was it just a...
We didn't notice any difference in her behavior. In fact, she got a second dose of MMR at about 5 years of age, and there was definitively no change in her behavior after that. She pretty much continued on in her mode of autistic behavior that required, in our opinion, a definitive educational approach to address her needs.
Thank you, Doctor. Mr. Bono, when did your child start manifesting the signs of autism?
Within about 30 days of the MMR. Quite honestly, when my wife had said, don't you see, mothers, I think, have a much keener sense of behaviors with their infants.
I understand, what I'm trying to find out is she received the MMR shot, and then you and your wife started noticing a change.
Indeed, exactly.
In 30 days, you say?
Well, within hours of the shot, we went home, and there was no sleeping that night, and we got rashes on the mm-hmm. body, and...
And it got progressively worse.
And then over the next week, gastrointestinal problems. Mm-hmm. Then, till finally, full-blown behaviors were odd.
And how old was your child when that started?
He was right at 16 months.
16 months. Mrs. Smith, when did your child start manifesting its change in behavior?
Well, at 16 months when they received... the host of multiple vaccines,
What were all those shots?
The DPT, the Hib, a hepatitis. It was their fourth DPT, their fourth Hib, their third hepatitis B, and their first MMR on that day. They came home. They slept for 24 hours most of that time. Didn't eat a whole lot. Long periods of sleep. Had over 100 degree temperatures in spite of giving them Tylenol before the vaccine and during the entire 24 hours. After that time, I figured, well, Jacob's sick again, because he was just kind of out of it and just didn't seem real interested in much. And
But this was about at 16 months.
Right.
You started
right.
seeing the manifest change
right.
in the child with autism.
And when we did go to the pediatrician, they just passed it off as him exerting his independence.
Okay. Ms. Reynolds?
Liam got his shot on June 27th, 1997. That was when he got his MMR and his Hib. And that was the day before he turned 17 months old. And a week later, I went up to visit my parents. They live up in Maryville, Tennessee. And we went up there for the 4th of July, and we started seeing some very strange, different behaviors showing up then. He wouldn't come when we called his name. He
he was doing weird pattern movements up against the wall, but it was within a week.
Right after he received the MMR shot.
Yes, sir.
Okay. Mr. Smythe?
About 20 months, our son diagnosed it. I included in the record his vaccine schedule and my other children's, and interestingly, he was given the hepatitis B the day he was born, and then received the other two shots, one of them within the first 6 months, a month later, 30 days later, and then another about 8 months later. He received 12 vaccines in the first 6 months, as the record shows, as compared to our other children who didn't in fact receive the hepatitis B until a year after he received his third shot.
Well, when did he start?
Right after the MMR, 20 months.
At 20 months, right after the MMR. So you four people right there all are in concert that right after the MMR shot, you started seeing the manifest change in your children. That's correct?
Yes.
Your child, Mr. Curtis?
I guess I'd have to be the dissenting opinion on this end of the table. I don't really remember the specific day of Morgan's MMR shots or any of his immunizations. He didn't really exhibit any behaviors. It wasn't anything that he did. It was what he never did. It was the fact that he never talked. And again, as I mentioned, it was a very gradual process. I think his behaviors, his idiosyncratic behaviors of lining up toys and the self-stimulatory behavior, the flapping of the hands, the spinning, all of that really started after he was two. It seemed like once we had a word for it, then it almost got worse. But we've thought about this a lot because this is a very common theory. You read about it on the net, you talk with other parents, and my wife and I have both discussed this at length. We really don't see any correlation between the time of his immunizations and the onset of any specific or more intense behaviors.
Okay, well, my last question then would be, did you notice shortly after his birth, some as he was progressing, some problems then?
I think, yes. The reason I say I think is because we wanted to believe that he was a late talker, a late developer. The only thing we noticed was that he wasn't speaking and that he didn't seem to react to the things that we did with him. But otherwise, he was a very normal, happy baby. He played, he interacted, he made lots of noises. He just never formed words and almost didn't seem to react to our speech. For a long time, we were very concerned about his hearing, that maybe he didn't hear properly. In fact, when his hearing was tested, in the first test, they said that he was deaf, and once they did the brainstem test that was conclusive, it turned out that his hearing was absolutely fine. It was just that he wasn't reacting to sound or voice.
Okay, Mr. Curtis, thank you very much. Go ahead.
I'm sorry. Quick. I also noticed that my son was given the DPT the same day he was given the MMR. So he got six vaccines on the same day. Yours did also?
Okay. Thank you, Mr. Waxman.
It takes a lot of courage for all of you to be here, and I want you to know how much I appreciate it, especially when you're talking about something personal and painful. And I know you're here to try to help us understand what you're going through so that we can try to find out about autism and we can spare others from going through what you're going through. And there is legislation. This committee doesn't have legislative authority, has ability to hold hearings and get information. But the committee that has a legislative jurisdiction, which I'm also on, is the Commerce Committee. And there we have a bill. It's H.R. 3301. It incorporates legislation by Congressman Greenwood, Congressman Bilirakis. Both Mr. Burton and I are on that bill, and it would do a lot to research more about the prevalence and ways to deal with autism. And I hope that will give us some of these answers that we so desperately want. Dr. Dankner, you're in a unique position. You're a father of an autistic child. You're also a pediatrician and an expert on infectious diseases. But your testimony is that, as you put it, you don't think there's sound evidence linking autism to the MMR vaccine. How can you say that when the other parents have given us evidence in their view, that their child developed autism after the vaccine? Isn't that sound evidence? As a scientist, should we consider it, and what do we need to prove that there is a connection, if there is one?
One thing that I'm not here to, disinvalidate the testimony of the other individuals. I know that from their heart they feel that these events occurred in relation to a specific time and place, and it would be wrong of me to make a challenge to anyone on this committee. This is a personal issue for a number of these individuals. However, as a clinical scientist, when we do research, I take care of HIV-infected children. It's important to identify causal events so that we don't do, as I mentioned, harm on either side of the fence of any of these issues. And I think it's important that if this committee or the scientific world feels that there's not enough evidence to generate a causal link between vaccination and autism or any other disorder, that those studies need to be done, and that people then should look at those studies in a critical view with appropriate peer review, and all individuals who are purporting one position versus another should be able to stand under the light of appropriate peer review to ensure that the scientific information is collected appropriately, analyzed appropriately, and discussed in an open forum, not in closed sessions, to ensure that the best information is provided to everyone so that, again, best decisions can be made by individuals. I'd like to bring a personal perspective as an infectious disease doctor. Unlike the other panel members, I have been on the other side of the fence of seeing children who have been harmed by vaccine-preventable diseases. I live close to the border, where the vaccination rate in Mexico is not the same as in the United States. I've seen children who have developed congenital rubella, a lifelong disabling condition. I've seen children die of measles during a measles epidemic in San Diego 10 years ago, even with the pretty reasonable vaccine rates, highly transmissible disease. I've seen children suffer from pertussis, hospitalized at significant rates. I think one has to, that position puts me in a position of being cautious about making any links, because if the vaccine rates fall in the United States, I can almost guarantee from my own personal experience that there will be individuals who will suffer on the other side of the fence. And those are the individuals that this committee usually does not hear about.
I'm not a scientist. I studied science at different levels of my education. And when I studied science, I was told that there is a scientific method to try to get answers. And the scientific method sometimes took a theory or a hypothesis and then tested it, and you had trials and control groups, and you try to find out whether that theory is correct or not. Sometimes theories turn out to be widely believed, but then they're discarded. We all studied the fact that people in the past didn't understand information that they should have. But they didn't understand. They didn't know. People didn't know about hygiene and connection in the hospitals. That used to be one of the most dangerous places to be because of the lack of hygiene. But you're a scientist. These others are parents. But from a scientific method, are you saying the theory is absolutely incorrect, or are you saying that we just don't know enough to say that it is correct?
There are other people who are going to testify here today who I think can probably better answer that. I was asked to come on the panel both as a parent and a scientist. My reading of what has been correlated to date does not appear to indicate a causal link. I think that that debate has not been settled and probably needs to be, so that we don't continue to move down avenues that may be less productive in terms of the resources that are necessary to identify other potential links to autism, what the needs are in the community, which I can tell you are great.
Let me just interrupt you because my time is up, but are you just saying to us, in other words, we shouldn't be alarmed about vaccinations and have parents refrain from vaccinating their kids because of this theory that at this point you don't think is gone through a scientific evaluation to be established as scientific fact.
I think an alarmist view is always of a concern. I'm a cautious individual. I think we just need to be cautious in how we approach this issue.
Thank you, Mr. Waxman. Dr. Danker, I hope that you'll have the ability to stay and hear some of the other scientists' positions just for your own information.
I planned on it.
Thank you very much. Ms. Marilla.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. I am very moved by the testimony that I've heard and read of you. You are indeed the heroes, and we see you as role models, and your children are very fortunate to have you as parents. So thank you for being here. I think the only question I want to ask is to Mr. Bono. When you said that you had to travel 12 hours for a five-minute treatment, I do not know enough about the background to know what that treatment is, why you have to travel 12 hours for it, and how you found out about it.
I have to travel 12 hours. That's deceiving. And first, let me apologize. It's 6 hours up and 6 hours back in one day. So it's 12 hours.
Significant.
I have to travel because the treatment, it's not recognized as helping my son. And it's not approved. It's secretin, and it's a slow push, is what they call it, an infusion of sorts. We found that going up about every 28 days is a real good cycle for Jackson. Without it, he will not have a normal bowel movement. He will have, acidic diarrhea, he won't digest food properly, he'll have rashes, unexplained rashes on
his. Who advised you that this would help in that area? Is there another doctor?
At the press conference, one of the doctors said that the parents have really been the ones in the forefront of finding treatment options for their children. And this was a parent, too. Her name is Victoria Beck. She had serendipitously discovered secretin working for her child as a result of an endoscopy. Laura and I had always thought that there was some connection between the gut and brain that needed to be bridged. And when we had heard about Victoria's experience, we were rather fascinated, and we began to read about it. That's how we arrived at that treatment.
Dr. Dankner, I just want to briefly ask you, it's your daughter who is autistic, but in general, as I mentioned in my opening statement, there is a prevalence among males with regard to autism. Are there some unique challenges that you face with a female rather than a male with autism?
Oh, yes. And those challenges are becoming more apparent now that she has achieved puberty. Luckily, she responds very well to sequence pictures. One of the social stories that was provided to her through her school at my wife's insistence, I have to admit that she has taken the forefront on this, is how to deal with menstruation. If you allow our daughter to sort of do her own thing, and she gets into a pattern, that pattern then becomes very difficult to break. And we have several holes in our wall. We could probably pay a drywaller a pretty sum of money. When she gets mad at things, she will kick holes here and there. Luckily, we're having a room addition put on very soon, so we'll take care of the last patch jobs that we did. But that's one issue that came up. Another that my wife and I feel very concerned about is the risk for her to be sexually abused as she gets older because of her inability to really indicate or express interactions with other individuals. As a number of the other panel discussions talked about with older children, my daughter comes home from school, you can ask her how her day went, and she'll say, fine. But you won't be able to, unless we're given a set of things that went on to school, she's not there to carry on small talk. That's not a major impetus in her life. She will interact with us because she has needs, and she'll seek us out for those. But if left to her own devices, she'll stay in her garage room, watch her TV, whatever video she finds the most appealing that day, and loves to play with the reverse and replay button on a regular basis. But yes, there are some special challenges, but I think there are challenges for the males who are growing up with autism also. There are things that they are gonna have to face as they get older. And I think as they get older, the challenges become different. And I think all the parents have to deal with the issue of what's gonna happen to their children as they get older, who's gonna take care of them when the parents get beyond an age that they can no longer take care of their children.
The toll on parents is immeasurable, obviously. Thank you, Mr. Chairman.
Thank you, Ms. Morello. Mr. Turner, do you have any questions?
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. Doctor, I just had one question for you, and I know this hearing centers on the problem of autism. Chairman's had personal experience with it in his family, and I know his also he's had some experience with a granddaughter with a hepatitis B vaccine. And I just wonder, is there any reason to question the age at which some of these vaccines are administered? I've always had the feeling that the younger the child, the more fragile they are, and therefore the impact, negative impact, if it be there, the potential certainly greater when those vaccines are administered at an early age. I've, of course, had particular interest in the hepatitis B vaccine, which is administered, I think, in most states now at birth routinely. In fact, I was in the home of a family in my district this weekend who has a 2.5-year-old child, severely disabled. Basically, the family spends most of their waking hours tending to the child, and they strongly suspect that the problem was a result of a hepatitis B vaccination. And that's administered at birth, and I have been told that there's really no logical argument for trying to vaccine a newborn because the threat of hepatitis B does not exist at that early an age, but it might be more appropriate vaccine for later in childhood or approaching the teenage years. So is there any reason to question the timing of some of these vaccines? One of our witnesses today talked about the large number of vaccines administered at one time.
Well, again, I wasn't called to the panel, I think, to give a long explanation of vaccine policy. There are lots of other individuals who have been involved in those policy-making decisions over the years, but I can give you my perspective once again from the diseases that we see in these age groups. Albeit hepatitis B is an uncommon disease process that children may or may not get exposed to, the more likely exposure is going to occur when they reach sexual debut, as we call it, where they could be easily exposed to hepatitis B from a partner. And that's one of the major concerns, and hepatitis B is the major cause of chronic liver disease in the United States. It's reached a rate where vaccination definitely would have an impact upon that disease in terms of its prevention. The reason for giving some vaccines earlier is to ensure that the vaccination gets performed. Rubella is a perfect example. When congenital rubella was identified, both in the United States, Australia, and Europe as a devastating disease linked definitively to the acquisition of rubella by mothers who were uninfected previously, no previous immunity to rubella. The approach was sort of taken differently by different nations. If you look at the United States, they focused on giving the rubella vaccine early in life so that you would eliminate the pool of individuals who were exposing adults to rubella. Whereas England took the approach of trying to vaccinate adolescent females primarily because they were the, quote, at-risk population who could transmit rubella to their unborn fetus. The experience in England was that it took them a lot longer to eliminate congenital rubella from their population. And the experience in the United States was an enormous success because even though you had women who were susceptible to rubella, they weren't being exposed. And as those children who got rubella vaccine early in life aged up into their childbearing years, they were no longer at risk of developing congenital rubella. And the result is that the United States sees probably about 2, 4, 5 cases of congenital rubella a year, and most of those are from individuals who either have not received vaccination or come from a foreign country where the vaccine rates are much lower. Additionally, the hepatitis, not the hepatitis, but the Haemophilus influenza B vaccine, the vast majority of H flu meningitis that we see occurred in children less than 24 months of age. If you wait to give the vaccine till they're 2 years of age, you've missed the peak period. We used to see at our children's hospital in San Diego 60 to 70 cases of Haemophilus influenza meningitis per year. It's a pretty devastating disease for most of the children. We see essentially one case about every 2 or 3 years now. And the last case we saw was in a mother who just sort of had her fourth child and just didn't get to the doctor to get the H flu vaccine provided. I think if you want to ask about the policies, you'll need to talk to the policymakers and come up with their conclusions. I can only give you my viewpoint from the standpoint of how I see infectious disease, the impact that I've seen upon it in our local community, and the diseases that I no longer see, which some doctors that are in practice now may never see her again, I think to the advantage of those particular children who aren't suffering from those particular diseases. I also wish that, to be fair to the other panel participants, that I recognize that I'm a physician, I bring certain issues to the table, but I think the other individuals have a lot to say also that needs to be heard, and I don't want to monopolize everyone's time.
Well, I appreciate your comments. I guess the only point I was trying to make, and perhaps our other witnesses on the second panel will help us with it, there's obviously good public policy reasons to have the vaccines given, but at a minimum, if the timing of those vaccines could be later in life for children, it seems at least we owe the public that information, because particularly in the case of hepatitis B, if the threat of hepatitis B only occurs at the time when a child has a potential of becoming sexually active, then it doesn't make a whole lot of sense to have a public policy that says we administer it on the second day of life. And if there is a risk, I, as a parent, certainly would not want that vaccine administered to my child at that point in time. And people need to have that information. Thank you so much, Doctor.
Gentlemen's time has expired. Thank you very much, Mr. Turner. Mr. LaTourette.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. And like Mr. Waxman and Chairman Burton, I want to thank each of you for sharing your experiences with your families today. And Mrs. Smith, my wife and I are the parents of 8-year-old twins, and we always said that if the twins had been first, they would have been last, because raising twins is enough of a challenge all by itself. I wasn't going to talk about what my friend from Texas was talking about, but it always amazed me, and I'm not smart enough to know the connection between vaccines and what brings you here today, but it did always amaze me that these vaccines, you'd bring your baby home and they'd turn bright red and have horrible fevers, and then say, well, you just have to hang on for a little while and everything's going to be okay, and this was a drug that was going to prevent some horrible childhood disease in the future. But why they were being exposed to these vaccines within the first couple of days of being born, or even the first few months of being born, is something that I do think we need to get a handle on. But Ms. Smith, I do want to talk to you about a portion of your testimony, and I think Mrs. Reynolds also, if I understand it, you may be following similar paths, and that is that you've had Jacob screened and tested for the presence of heavy metals and fungi and other foreign substances within his system, and that he's currently undergoing some nutritional therapy and things. And I'm wondering if you could share those experiences with us. And first of all, I think it was you, Mrs. Smith, that wrote that the results of that screening were shocking, and it was amazing that he was doing it the results of, is it you that had Dr. Cave, Dr. Stephanie Cave?
Yes.
Okay.
We both.
You both have Dr. Stephanie Cave.
Right.
Okay, well maybe one at a time or in tandem. Tell us a little bit about Dr. Cave's work and what about the results of these screenings were shocking, and what sorts of things now Liam and Jacob are going through that give you hope and point in the direction of this is a biomedical condition rather than a neurological condition.
Well, in my case, it's...
Would you pull the mic close so both of you can...
In my case, it's clearly not a genetic issue, considering that they're identical. The other reason I don't feel that it was a neurological disorder that he was born with is because his descent into autism happened so rapidly. He was completely with me, and he descended into autism so rapidly, and that to me is not a neurological order that he had at birth. Also, I feel that it was not a neurological disorder that he was born with, because when he was 2.5, we had several professionals recommend that we put him on medications. I don't know what type of medications they said, such as Ritalin. I never pursued that avenue because to me, I felt like medicating a 2.5-year-old child was simply not good enough when I didn't know what his body was already doing. I went to see Dr. Cave, and she ran blood tests and urine tests and stool samples to check what deficiencies he had, the areas that he had, that he was lacking in, his amino acids, etc. We found that he had 10 food allergies. Because he had been on repeated antibiotics, he had extremely high, out of 23 markers of fungal and yeast infection, he was high in 20. He was chromium, zinc, magnesium, and copper deficient. He was B5 deficient. What else? Anyway, I'm trying to remember. So basically what we did was we immediately started taking out what was bad and putting back what was good, and taking him off the foods he was allergic to. And within 5 days, my son, that had only a couple of words in his language and was very lost, said a full appropriate sentence and started speaking again. And so the rapid improvement also shows me that this was not a neurological disorder in his case.
And Mrs. Reynolds, are you also, is Liam also undergoing similar therapy and with similar?
Yes, he is. When he was diagnosed in May of 98, we put him on a strict gluten-free, casein-free diet that Dr. Cave prescribed, where he wasn't allowed to eat any of those substances because his body was taking those things and actually manufacturing morphine, which was what was making him just sit and stare and not respond appropriately to things. And since that time, he's undergone an MRI, EEGs, all the normal things that they run on autistic children, and those all point to normal things. But when you start doing blood work and stool work and urinalysis, and they've measured for toxic metals in his hair, she suggested that we give him a medication that would help pull out the heavy metals that he had been exposed to. And my husband and I were so gun-shy at this point in dealing with doctors that we pulled out the PDR and read through it, and we were like, I don't know, this sounds a little weird to me. I don't think we're going to try this. And we took Liam to an environmental toxicologist who did some blood work and told us that the shape of Liam's blood, he had stippled cells that pointed, it would be the same as a plant worker that had had serious toxic heavy metal exposure, and that our son's blood cells were malformed as a result of the heavy metal exposure that he had received. And we've given him this medication several times. We were able in December to get a good urine sample, which is a little challenge around our house. And we finally were able to test that, and the normal range for, and I'm going to probably mess this up, but the normal range for anything to show up in their bodies is between 0 and 6. And his lead and mercury had reduced down to normal ranges, but his levels of 10 were completely off the charts. They weren't even measurable. They were up around 250.
Did you say 10?
10. So he's...
And if I can just beg the chairman's indulgence, is he likewise receiving, aside from the medication that you're talking about, a nutritional
program? He receives a number of nutritional supplements every day. He's on an antifungal medication because we've been dealing with a yeast infection that just will not go away for 3 years, that makes him just
It's a real mess. He's just a walking biological nightmare. And he looks as healthy as a horse. He's got this great skin. He's got these great pink cheeks. He's a beautiful, beautiful little boy. But if you take it down to the cellular and the molecular level, you can see that this child is a total mess.
Thank you very much.
You're welcome.
Thank you very much, Mr. LaTourette. Ms. Bigger, did you have any questions? Well, let me just thank this panel. I just want to say to the four of you who have experienced this change right after the MMR shot, my daughter's sitting back there, and I and my daughter experienced exactly the same things that you did. And I believe what you're saying, and we're going to pursue that as diligently as possible, because I can't believe that that's just a coincidence that the shot is given, and within a very short time, he got 9 shots in one day, the MMR and the DPAT and what was the other one? Yeah. And within just a matter of a few days, instead of being the normal child that we played with and talked and everything else, he was running around banging his head against the wall, flailing his arms. And when people tell me that that was a genetic problem, I'm telling you that they're just nuts. That's not the way it was. And with that, I want to thank this panel very much, and we'll now go to our next panel. Thank you very much.
Thank you, Congressman.
Thank you.
Look at the key. Yeah, you can give me something like that, but yeah, where's the next panel? Give me the next thing. We will now welcome our second panel to the witness table, Dr. Andrew Wakefield, who came all the way from merry old England. We appreciate him being here. Professor John O'Leary, whom I'm sure you'll notice after he starts talking, he's from Ireland. Dr. Vijendra Singh, appreciate you being here, Dr. Singh. Dr. Colleen Boyle, Dr. Paul Offit, and Dr. Brent Taylor. Are you all at the table? Would you please rise so we can swear you in, please? You solemnly swear to tell the whole truth and nothing but the truth, so help you God. Have a seat. Dr. Wakefield, would you like to start this panel?
Yes, thank you, Mr. Chairman, members of the committee. It's a great privilege to be here. The purpose of my testimony is to report the results of the clinical and scientific investigation of a series of children with autism. Now, nothing in this testimony should be construed as anti-vaccine. Rather, I advocate the safest vaccination strategies for the protection of children and the control of communicable disease. I also am here on my behalf representing the children who have come to me for investigation. I'd like you to look at the screen, if you would, please, and I'll take you through the presentation. Next slide, please. I just, as a little bit of background, this represents 12 years of intensive clinical and scientific research, collaborative research, into the causes and mechanisms of bowel inflammation. I'm a gastroenterologist. The principal authors of this work have contributed to over 1,500 peer-reviewed and published papers, scientific papers, and abstracts. And again, these represent my views. Next slide, please. I want to report the results today from the first 60 children that we have investigated. We have now investigated over 150 children, and the results that I'm going to describe are pertinent to all those children, bar about 4. The range of psychiatric assessments, the great majority had autism, but there was a spectrum of neuropsychiatric problem, including Asperger's syndrome and attention deficit disorder. And by far and away, the most important investigation has been direct visualization of the bowel and taking biopsies by the procedure of ileocolonoscopy. This is a flexible instrument introduced into the bottom end to take a biopsy. Next slide, please. What you've heard this morning is a classical description of two different types of autism from the parents. You have heard about the children that we have seen, those who have gone off after a period of normal development, in the face, many of them, of multiple vaccine exposures with severe gastrointestinal symptoms. The other type, described very articulately, was of an insidious failure to acquire skills. That's an extremely important point. And the essence of what I'm going to present today is based upon conventional clinical medicine. It is listening to the patient. Here is a child who was entirely normal for the first year of life and went off a week after receiving his MMR vaccine. He is exactly as the four were described earlier. Next slide, please. The classical features in these children are of pain. There is a radiograph here of the abdomen, and there is fecal impaction. When these children came to us, the feature was of diarrhea, but in fact, this turned out to be what we call spurious or overflow diarrhea. There were soiling, loss of continence, fastidious eating habits, reflux, and nighttime wakening. They used to get heartburn, and they wake up very distressed. And these symptoms are the same wherever you go. If I listen to parents from Canada, from the States, from Europe, from Australia, the story is the same. Next slide, please. The associated features that we have in these children are of atopy, asthma, eczema, and hay fever. There is a refractory upper respiratory tract infections. They do not deal with common childhood infections, colds, well. And there is a very high level of autoimmune disease in the family, thyroid disease, diabetes, for example. Next slide, please. This is the insider's view of the small intestine. The panel on the top left is of what it should look like in a child. The bottom left is of lymphoid nodular hyperplasia. These are swelling of the lymph glands in the bowel. These are rather like tonsils, and when they swell, they cause pain and symptoms. And Mr. Waxman asked for reproducibility. He's absolutely right, and up on the top right-hand panel, you see a child who was scoped in the United States with exactly the same symptoms. So this is reproducible in two different continents. We've compared it with controls, and the graph in the bottom right shows that even in children who come to us with gastrointestinal symptoms who are scoped, the finding of lymphoid nodular hyperplasia is relatively uncommon. The bar on the left, 85% of them show no evidence of it, but virtually all of our autistic children show evidence of lymphoid hyperplasia, either mild, moderate, or severe. Next slide, please. There are histological changes down the microscope which show there is a definite disease. The top left-hand panel is normal. The bottom right-hand panel, for example, shows what is called a crypt abscess, that is pus, in the bowel wall. And this is a feature that we see in children and adults with ulcerative colitis. There is a clear, demonstrable, albeit subtle, pathology. Next slide, please. A further paper that's due to be published soon has taken this to one further level and asked, is this disease distinct from classical inflammatory bowel disease, Crohn's and colitis, or is it something new? And the data, at least so far, suggest that it is something new. Next slide, please. We have described this feature in the gut, lymphoid hyperplasia and colitis, in children with autism. From this same city, from Georgetown University, Professor Joe Belanti has described it in children with attention deficit disorder. Coming back to the question, is this a spectrum of disorders which have at their heart some gastrointestinal abnormality? Next slide, please. Lymphoid nodular hyperplasia classically occurs in the presence of immunodeficiency. We do see it during acute infection, but it's classically associated with immunodeficiency. Are our children immunodeficient? As a group, the answer is yes, they are. And this graph just shows you a particular count of a certain type of immune cell in the blood. And these are the green line is the upper limit for normal. The red line is the lower limit for normal. Each blue dot represents a child. And you can see that the great majority sit at or below the lower limit of normal. Not only are they numerically deficient, their immune system does not respond appropriately to common recall antigens when compared with normal age-matched children. In other words, if you give them a skin prick test for pertussis or diphtheria, they mount no response. Next slide, please. So the key features of the syndrome are developmental regression, ileocolonic lymphoid hyperplasia, swelling of these tonsil tissues, enterocolitis, that means inflammation of the small and large intestine, and an immunodeficiency. Next slide, please. So it's a real syndrome. There is a remarkably consistent pattern of bowel inflammation, and it provides us with vital clues. Now, what are those clues? Next slide, please. Well, the story as told to us, which we have an obligation to report, is that the majority of children regressed following a period of normal development in the face of MMR vaccination. That does not mean it is the cause of the disease. We also had two children who regressed after classical measles infection, one after the monovalent measles vaccine, and one after a rare vasculitic rash. 36% of parents could contemporaneously identify no particular environmental hit. Next slide, please. Has measles, have common childhood infections been linked to autism before? Is there a reason to go into this and look at it? The answer is yes, there is. And this is a paper that came from the Harvard School of Public Health, and it showed that atypical patterns of exposure to common childhood infections, measles, mumps, chickenpox, rubella, were a risk for autism in the child. By atypical, I mean maternal exposure when pregnant or neonatal exposure. What was intriguing about this, and which we may come to later, is that if you were a pregnant mother who was exposed to more than one of these common infections at the same time, or indeed an infant child, then your risk of autism was both greater and the severity of the autism was greater. Question, was there a compound effect of more than one infection? It's also been shown that children born in and around epidemics of measles and rubella have higher rates of this disease. Next slide, please. What about vaccines? This is a paper from the Vaccine Damage Compensation Board in the United States. Acute encephalopathy followed by permanent brain injury or death associated with further attenuated measles vaccine. What was intriguing in this cohort of children who fulfilled rather strict criteria is that 43 of 48 underwent developmental regression as part of their syndrome. So we have this other pattern of exposure to measles as the further attenuated vaccine, children undergoing developmental regression. Next slide, please. So to summarize, that unusual patterns of exposure to common childhood infections are associated with autism and developmental regression. Next slide, please. Now here is the clue. This is the important image, and here you see the insider's view again, this swollen tonsillar tissue, because this, if you are looking for an infection, is where you should be looking. Next slide, please. When you look down the microscope, this is what that swollen tonsil tissue looks like, and you are looking in the center of that for the infection. This is a response to a foreign agent, a foreign antigen, usually an infection. And so if you are looking for the cause of that, that is where you are looking. Next slide, please. This is a very high power micrograph of a single cell called a follicular dendritic cell. And this is crucial because if you are looking for the source of that infection, not only are you looking in that lymphoid follicle, not only in the center of the lymphoid follicle, but in this specific cell. Next slide, please. And when we look in that specific cell using an antibody which picks up measles protein and only measles protein, we find it in that cell. We do not find it in other cells throughout the tissue. We find it in that cell. Next slide, please. You look for other viruses. You ask the question, is this just a non-specific response? Do we find other viruses in there? So you look for adenovirus, herpes simplex 1 and 2, rubella, mumps, HIV, and other crucial controls that Mr. Waxman referred to earlier, and you do not find them. They are not there. So at least within the context of this study, this appears to be specific for measles virus. Next slide, please. Next question, is there an antibody? Is there an immune response to the virus in these children? The mere presence does not make it the cause. Is there an immune response? We take the children, the autistic children, and we compare them with age-matched controls, and we look at measles antibody titers. We also look at controls of mumps, rubella, and cytomegalovirus, other common childhood infections. The only one for which there is a statistically significant difference between the cases and the controls is for the measles virus. Next slide, please. We had failed completely to identify this virus by molecular amplification technology. In my laboratory, we had a reaction that was sensitive to about 10,000 copies. Anything less, we couldn't find it. The Japanese had succeeded, and so we sent 9 blood samples from our children to the Japanese laboratory. We also sent 21 other patients. We mixed them up. We did not tell them what they were getting. They just had a label, a control label, and they identified measles virus in 3 of those 9 children in the peripheral blood. And that is an intriguing finding. This is consistent with, but not definitely vaccine strain. One cannot say that. This is consistent with, but there it is. And this was a blinded controlled study. Next slide, please. Very briefly to finish up, what is the link between the gut and the brain? Because this is one of the most difficult things for people to understand. How can the gut influence the brain? I come from a liver unit where we see patients with chronic liver failure, acute liver failure, all the time. And one of the classical manifestations of that, next slide please, is hepatic encephalopathy. And this is where the gut, the liver is damaged, is diseased, and fails to degrade the chemical constituents of the bowel that come through. It fails to mop them up and clear them out. They impact upon the brain. This is largely reversible. If you're hit with these for long enough, it becomes irreversible. And the question is, therefore, at least we have biologically a plausible hypothesis, a testable hypothesis, that elements from the gut, undegraded chemicals from the gut, including the opioids that were referred to by Shelley Reynolds, may be getting through, may not be metabolized, may be impacting upon the rapidly developing brain during the first few years of life and producing residual cognitive deficit, which we recognize as autism. Next slide, please. And so finally, in summary, we have an environmental insult in perhaps a genetically susceptible child. The problem is that if you go to Sweden now, autism affects over 1.2% of the pediatric population. So if that is a genetic background, it is clearly widely distributed within the population, that we believe that in many children, clearly this subset of autistics, it leads to gut infection and damage. That leads to an ingress, an impaired metabolism, degradation of these chemicals from the gut that then get through and impact upon the brain. And the dysregulated immune system, which measles classically can produce, also encourages immune diseases, atopic diseases, and immunodysregulation. Thank you, sir.
Thank you, Dr. Professor O'Leary.
Mr. Chairman and members of the committee, the purpose of my testimony is to report the scientific results in a series of children with autistic enterocolitis that has just been described to you. And nothing in my testimony should or must be construed as anti-vaccine. Rather, it encourages safe vaccination strategies. The opinions I'm expressing in the text and in my presentation are those of my own. The studies were undertaken following an approach made to me by Dr. Andrew Wakefield, who has just submitted independent testimony. The studies represent a transnational, multidisciplinary research program aimed at elucidating the causes and pathogenesis of inflammatory bowel diseases in association with developmental disorders of childhood. Next slide. Dr. Wakefield has alluded to measles virus as a potential associated factor in the pathogenesis of autistic enterocolitis, and he came to our laboratory to seek molecular confirmation. Next slide. Next, please. He set us some questions. Next. First question, was measles virus present in gut biopsies from these children? Next. Where was it located? How much was there? Could it be sequenced? Could we actually confirm there was measles virus? And finally, could different molecular technologies actually independently confirm the presence of measles virus? May I inform you that I am a pathologist and a molecular biologist. My area of diagnostic expertise is histopathology, which is understanding and examining the cellular basis of disease. Next slide, please. The blinded study included 47 bases of disease. Next slide, please. The blinded study included 46 cases. 25 children had a diagnosis of autistic enterocolitis, and 21 controls were included in the study, including 15 normal children. They did not have a developmental disorder. 4 children with Crohn's disease, which is a chronic inflammatory bowel disease condition, and 2 children with ulcerative colitis, a very similar condition, but it's histologically different. We examined terminal ileal biopsies, and from the blocks of tissue that were given to us, we looked at 4 to 6 serial sections on the one case. What we wanted to do that was to see if we could identify the virus, could we replicate it on multiple sections from the one patient. And where available, fresh tissue was examined. Next slide. The positive control material in this study were transfected measles virus infected Vero cells, which contain measles virus genome, and measles virus infected brain tissue. As negative controls, we screened a panel of other virally infected cell lines. Next slide. To confirm the presence of measles virus, we adopted a five-hit strategy. The first was to localize and identify the presence of measles virus RNA in the tissue sections from these patients. Sorry, could you go back to the next slide? The second was to quantify using a technology called TACMAN real-time quantitative PCR. I've worked in this technology for the last 6 years. It's approximately 1,000 times more sensitive than existing PCR-based technologies. And finally, we wanted to confirm the sequence of the virus, so we employed capillary fluorescent-based sequencing. Next slide. Let me summarize what in-cell PCR is. I know this is technical, but I think it's extremely important. Measles virus is an RNA virus. An RNA, when it's removed from the body, is extremely easily degradable. PCR basically is like a photocopying reaction. We can make multiple copies of a particular gene that we're interested in looking for. In-cell PCR allows us to demonstrate these genetic sequences in cells and without a cells, looking down the microscope. Next slide. TACMAN quantitative PCR basically is a revolutionary PCR-based technology, which is sequence detection specific. You will only get a positive result in this assay if the desired gene of interest that you're looking for is present in the tissue section. Next slide. In our laboratory, we're one of the few laboratories in the world that actually perform RNA inhibition assays. This is effectively to test how degraded the RNA in our samples are, and number two, is there anything in the environment of the laboratory contributing to the breakdown of RNA in tissue samples or cells? Next slide. I think it's extremely important in relation to the detection of low copy viral infections, and I think our laboratory has a reputation for the detection of low viral copy numbers, that we have strict anti-contamination measures. What I mean here is that we do not want to generate false positive results. So we have separate isolated extraction and PCR areas. This is in a newly built, custom-designed molecular biology facility. We have two independent laboratory sites, and for the purpose of this investigation, we employed in-situ hybridization, which is basically a way of taking a cloned or a fragment of DNA or RNA that you've got in your laboratory and looking for the presence of that in a tissue section or cell. We can use the technology of in-cell PCR that I've described, solution phase PCR, and TACMAN PCR, which are complementary technologies. But TACMAN PCR is 1,000 times more sensitive than standard solution phase PCR technologies, and then sequencing. Next slide, please. Just again to reiterate the point, our laboratories go to desperate lengths, number one, to prove that we do not have RNA inhibition, but secondly, to prove that we do not have contamination. And we purposely, in all of our plates, set up contamination assays. This is effectively to outrule the possible generation of false positive results. Again, I would appeal to the non-scientific members of the committee. This is an extremely important control that must be included if you're looking for low copy viral gene detections. Next slide, please. And of course, to confirm the presence of measles virus, the gold standard is to confirm the sequence of the virus to say, yes, this is measles virus RNA that we've got in the tissue sections. Next slide, please. So let's look at the results now. Next slide. Next slide. Next slide, please. Sorry, could you go back one slide? We carried out an extensive set of optimization reactions where we had cloned measles virus clones looking at several regions of the measles virus genome, F, N, and H. The technical detail of this is not important. But just to show you that we could look at several genes within the measles virus genome, and we could reproducibly make copies of these or amplify them. The bottom panel shows you an experiment which allows us to detect measles virus in Vero cells, showing what the optimal concentration of the probe that we require to detect the virus is. And you can see clearly that the optimal concentration is 1 to 1.5 micrograms per mil. Next slide, please. This slide shows the results of in-cell PCR by two different technologies. One is in-cell solution-based PCR, the other is in-cell TACMAN PCR, which produces a green signal in the right-hand panels, top and bottom. Again, it demonstrates that we can clearly identify measles virus in these transfected cells. Next slide, please. This is a patient with subacute sclerosing panencephalitis. Measles virus is the cause of this condition. So, of course, if we are to reliably detect measles virus in biopsies from the children that Dr. Wakefield provided to us, we should, of course, be able to identify measles virus in brain biopsies from patients with SSPE. The left panel and the middle panel shows measles virus presence in these biopsies, and the right-hand panel is a negative control. Next slide, please. And this is a case, an autistic child number one. You can see the top left-hand panel is a microscopic appearance of what the gut looks like. And this is not normal gut epithelium from a child. It's heavily inflamed. The bottom left-hand panel shows a spidery black deposit out width of the cells that are in green. And this is actually measles virus RNA. The top right-hand panel, again in a different field, shows a heavier deposit of black, which again is measles virus. And again, I need to point out to you that this is out width of the cells that are surrounding it. Measles virus was located in the tonsils, in the lymphoid hyperplastic areas that Dr. Wakefield described on endoscopy. And the negative control is absolutely clean. Next slide, please. This is another case, a second autistic child, again showing very similar findings. A black deposit, which is measles virus, outside of inflammatory cells, associating in a fibrillary matrix. And the negative controls here for mumps are absolutely clean. Next slide, please. But I think this slide is extremely important. If you look at the left-hand panel, this is measles virus for the nucleocapsid gene. It's a black signal. It again is outwith of the cells, but it's got a spidery, cobwebby morphology. There are little processes and tentacles coming out of this region. If you look at the top right-hand panel, the follicular dendritic cell has processes, dendrites, which form the cell matrix, which is very, very similar to what we're seeing in the left-hand panel. And the immunocytochemical staining analysis, which Dr. Wakefield alluded to, gives us exactly the same result. Next slide, please. By solution phase PCR, by what we call fairly standard laboratory protocols, we can detect measles virus in gut biopsies from these children, and the negative controls are appropriately negative. Next slide, please. And even in a paraffin-embedded tissue section that has probably been sitting around in wax for 4 to 5 years, we can detect measles virus. That is an astounding finding in view of the fact that wax and fixation by itself breaks down RNA. And this graph shows in real time, we can look at the accumulation of the product or the PCR product that we're making, confirming that measles virus is actually present in this biopsy. Next slide. And of course, we can sequence it. And we can say that this is measles virus RNA present in the biopsies of these children. To do this properly, you need to do it in a forward and negative strand. I started off by saying that measles virus is an RNA virus. When we make copies of the RNA virus, we make copies in two-strand forms. So if we are to sequence it, we should sequence in a forward and reverse strand. Looking at that electrophoretogram, the sequences in both directions are exactly the same. Next slide, please. So in summary then, in terms of the association that Andrew Wakefield alluded to, I can confirm that his hypothesis is correct. 24 out of 25 children, that's 96% of the children's biopsies that he sent to my laboratory, blinded, children with autistic enterocolitis, harbor measles virus genomes. 3 out of 4 patients with Crohn's disease, either children with Crohn's disease, and 1 out of 2 children with ulcerative colitis also contain measles virus. That's an interesting biological fact. Finally, 1 of 15, 6.6% of controlled children harbored measles virus genome. And I think it doesn't take great statistical analysis to work out that there is a significant difference between 24 out of 25 and 1 out of 15. Next slide. Solution phase RT-PCR, which is standard laboratory-based technology, was positive in all children with autistic enterocolitis for different regions of the measles virus genome. It's extremely important. And we can sequence measles virus isolates from these children. Final slide, please. However, the infection that is present in these children is an extremely low copy, at about 55 to 30 transcripts per approximately 2,000 cells. Now, again, I want to add some technical overlay on this. The way that we quantify RNA in our laboratory is by a method called copy RNA. Again, we're one of the few laboratories worldwide that would do this. That's the most accurate way of actually measuring RNA, and indeed industry now is accepting this as a standard way of quantitating RNA in cells and tissue sections. And finally, the presence of measles virus was identified by in situ hybridization, by solution phase PCR, by TACMAN PCR, by in-cell PCR, by sequencing. This really, in terms of technology, is as good as it gets right now. And I hope I have given you evidence here which is compelling in relation to the presence of measles virus in children with autistic enterocolitis. Thank you for your time and attention.
Thank you, Professor. And when we get to the question and answer phase, I'm sure that we'll try to ask questions in layman terms and try to get some answers so we can understand everything that both you and Dr. Wakefield said. But I think we got the gist of it. Dr. Singh?
Thank you very much, Chairman, please.
Pull the microphone as close as you can to you, please.
I didn't realize that I could have shown a couple of slides as well to make the point much more to the layman language. But I'll try and explain the results and the research that I'm involved in. It's been nearly 25 years that I have been involved with so-called childhood diseases from the immunology side as well as pediatric neurology side. I was working at Children's Hospital in Vancouver, Canada. That's where I started my career for childhood diseases. And early on, I saw a few names, few examples of autism mentioned in congenital rubella syndrome. It was a fascinating observation because at that time, I was very, very excited about the research of virus infections and nervous system disorders. That really led me to kind of sidewalk back and forth between nervous system disorders and virus infections and immunology. So the whole thing here is that we need to be considering combination of these disciplines that we talk about. We're not going to be able to answer any question, as far as I'm concerned, for nervous system diseases simply by studying psychology or simply by looking at the epidemiology data. We need to be coming together as a team to focus studies of nervous system, immune system, and whatever else comes into the picture. That is one major focus of attention that at least I am taking for my future research. Autism as an immune disorder, I think I'm probably one of the earlier investigators who started working on the immunity and autism connection. Followed by that was my theory that autoimmunity is a very important process in autism. And that's partly because I was studying autoimmunity in nervous system disorders, such as multiple sclerosis, such as Alzheimer's disease. Quite frankly, some of my earlier work in Alzheimer's disease has opened way. Now, people today, they are actually using immunology as a platform to design treatments for Alzheimer's disease. It was funny to see in news last night, some doctor has new approach. He says he's going to be using immunology as a means of trying to activate nervous system in order to correct the Alzheimer's problem. Wasn't that fascinating stuff? At least to me it is. So I started to pay attention more and more to autism. And the results that I'm going to share with you are actually quite unique to autism. They are part of the nervous system, but they are being analyzed by the immune system research. I know there are people, especially who are funded by NIH or they are funded by CDC, they continue to have no mention at all of this so-called immunology research or autoimmunity research. I've been invited by the NIH panel. I made two trips to NIH panels. I made a visit to Institute of Medicine, National Academy of Science, about a year and a half, 2 years ago. And if you hear those people who have been funded by these agencies, and when they go out and present, they don't even mention anything. NIH people prepared a document of that meeting. It was designed for updating screening and diagnostic criteria. If you read that document, there is virtually no mention of this sort of research. To me, it is horrifying, mind-boggling. So, is it because people out there in the scientific community, they don't want to buy the argument, or they are just being naive, what is already coming out in way of solid, decent, experimentally proven research? Now, having given that background, let me show you some of the results. First of all, I started looking at autism as an autoimmune disorder, as I mentioned. And what we have found is over the last 5-6 years of research, and I think now my numbers of cases studied is approaching about 400 cases. Very early on, I wanted to study myelination problem in the brain. Now, you will say, what is myelination? It is one of the most critical events in the nervous system development. So when a child is actually growing, this process, myelination process, this is very important. It's like really more or less like a mother will really feed a child and perhaps nurse in such a way that this process has to be nurtured very, very carefully. Having said that, so what we are finding is autoantibodies. Autoantibodies are the hallmark of autoimmune process. It's like if you have an autoimmune process, you're going to have autoantibodies. But those autoantibodies, if you have them against an organ which is affected in a disease, in autism, what would be? That would be brain. So we are finding autoantibodies. I have a chart here to show you. First chart, that dark bar on the right-hand side, it is reaching a percentage of about 80-85% positive. I don't think I have those, Beth, in the original. I'd be glad to pass them on.
We'll accept that and take it and put it into the record and use it for further examination.
We'll do that. What I'm trying to illustrate in this illustration is, in this chart, is that we have number of normal children, normal adults, patients with other disorders, Down syndrome. None of those seem to show up. On a rare occasion, in a 1-2% positive in the normal or control population. Here we have a observation, scientific observation, which is anybody can go out there and repeat it. I don't think I need to use any difficult thing to illustrate that point. It's consistently reproducible result. And it's happening now in children all over the world, because I'm getting specimens from overseas as well, not just the national specimens. So it's a very important thing. Furthermore, I find that particular protein marker is selective, because I've now studied two additional markers of the same structure in the brain. I don't find that phenomena. Let me move on to the next issue, and that is, what happens is, assuming there is an autoimmune process, most autoimmune diseases are triggered by virus infections. So I started to think about looking at virus. I wasn't thinking of vaccine issue here. I was thinking of virus infection. And quite surprisingly, when I started to do antibody measurements to virus which are out there or temporarily associated, What I find is measles virus stands out as statistically significant in terms of its antibodies, significantly much higher in these children. So these children have what is so-called a hyperimmune response to measles virus, not other viruses. We studied rubella virus, HHV6 virus, cytomegalovirus. None of those three viruses showed that pattern, I think. And furthermore, the important thing is the measles antibodies we have measured now by two different technology, and the result is the same, a statistically significant increase. Next thing I want to point out is, then the question was, can I see anything correlative between these two parameters? Quite strongly, I found that brain autoantibodies positive patients also had measles antibody levels very high. So higher the antibody level to virus, measles virus, there was higher the chance of brain autoantibody. It doesn't take too much intelligence to make some sense here now. Then, over the years, some of these families have been sending me notes, written notes, or telephone calls and so on. And I started to get this whole, and every time I was going out to make my presentation, people will tell me about vaccine connection with autism. Early on, I wasn't sure what was happening. So, well, I tried to put together their own reports, and the report looks like this pie in the pie chart. Nearly 53% of the families reported their child got autism because of MMR. Remaining 30% said it was because of DPT shot. And then about 15%, this was a category critical for two reasons. About 7% said they are not sure whether it was measles or DPT, but remaining 7% had no history of vaccination connection. At least they did not make the connection. And I wonder if that 7% or 8% category, that's where Dr. Duncan's child might be fitting into. The last thing I want to make a point here is this is a very recent research, not published yet. And this is something I last year showed a slide in my presentation in a meeting which was held in Orlando, Florida. And this is a observation, antibody to measles, mumps, rubella itself. I decided to start with measles, mumps, rubella because that is the largest population which was reported to me as being affected by measles vaccine. So what we found is we took the vaccine preparation itself and we decided to examine antibodies in these children. Normal children do not show any antibody to a protein that I will point out in a second, but children with autism, nearly 65% of them showed that antibody. Actually, I can illustrate that point a little bit more. If we just imagine if we just imagine I'm a molecule, a preparation of measles, mumps, rubella, this protein, this antibody that I'm detecting will be something like detecting this code pin. In other words, this protein, which is present in the measles, mumps, rubella vaccine preparation, has antibodies, not the normal children. And I think that's a very, very important laboratory-based research evidence. If anybody wants to make a criticism of that, of course, they are at liberty to do so. However, I find this is a scientifically very, very important observation, trying to say perhaps there is a good connection, there is something happening with this measles, mumps, rubella vaccine in these children. Something is unusual. So let me basically, after having illustrated some of these points, I want to make a final comment, basically, and that is, if you really look at the literature reported on the vaccine adverse reactions, I don't think you will need a crystal ball to see that vaccines have adverse reactions. Literature is full of those reports. What is not there is, it's never been reported, or at least the officials from the CDC, they continue not to mention anything about it. What they mention is vaccines are good. Every week you will read in the newspaper, you will hear about it on the television. And I don't dispute that vaccines are very, very important. What my concern is as a researcher, now more so than it was ever before, and that is we must pay attention to the safety of these vaccines. It is missing. It has not been disclosed publicly. I don't think it exists in literature. Therefore, I urge the Reform Committee to look into new particular policies concerning vaccine safety issue. Thank you very much.
Thank you, Dr. Singh. Dr. Boyle, would you pull the mic close to you?
Good afternoon, Mr. Chairman and members of the committee. I am Dr. Colleen Boyle, Chief of the Developmental Disabilities Branch at the Centers for Disease Control and Prevention. And I am presenting the agency's testimony, and I am accompanied by Dr. Ben Schwartz, who is the Acting Director of the Epidemiology and Surveillance Division at the National Immunization Program at CDC. I am pleased to discuss our work at CDC to prevent developmental disabilities, including autism. I wanted to begin by assuring the parents that we have heard from today that CDC is concerned about autism, and that we are working hard to find the causes of autism and other developmental disabilities so that all children will have the opportunity to have a healthy and productive future. Autism is a serious developmental disability which can have profound impact on children and their families. It is characterized by qualitative impairments in social interactions and communication, and a pattern of restrictive, repetitive, and stereotypic behaviors, interests, and activities. Autism may require long-term special education and care at a cost of more than $30,000 per year. Costs for residential care can be $80,000 to $100,000 per year. CDC's role in preventing developmental disabilities, including autism, is to track the disease rates in the population and to identify causes of this condition. CDC can then establish prevention programs and then evaluate how well these programs work. We do not know if autism rates are going up. Early studies found autism rates in the range of 4 to 6 per 10,000 children using a narrow set of criteria. More recent studies have reported rates averaging 12 per 10,000 children, but these studies have used different criteria than the earlier studies. CDC is not certain how much of the reported increase is due to changes in the definition of autism or an improved recognition of this condition over time. We also do not know if other factors have contributed to the larger numbers of children seeking treatment. CDC is currently developing ways to better measure autism. In 1998, we added autism to our Metropolitan Atlanta Developmental Disability Surveillance Program. This program, which also monitors other serious developmental disabilities, such as mental retardation and cerebral palsy among school-aged children in Atlanta, is the only community-wide study in the United States. CDC has just funded Marshall University in West Virginia to start tracking autism in 6 counties in that state. At this point, I want to briefly describe our activities in Brick Township, New Jersey, and in investigating the alleged association between autism and the MMR vaccination. In early 1998, the CDC and the Agency for Toxic Substances and Disease Registry, or known as ATSDR, were contacted by the New Jersey Health Department, Senator Robert Torricelli and Representative Christopher Smith, requesting CDC investigate autism rates in Brick Township. They were concerned that the number of children with autism was too high. In response, CDC conducted a study of children with autism living in Brick Township during 1998, and ATSDR investigated sources of environmental pollution and exposure routes in Brick Township. All the data have been collected, and the results are currently undergoing scientific review. Once this review is completed, we will provide the report first to the parents of the affected community, the parents of the affected children, the community, and then the local and state health departments. And we would be pleased to brief interested members or their staff on the results of this work at the time we make them available to the community. As the committee committee is aware, a theory links the MMR vaccine and autism, which has generated public interest and some controversy. CDC believes that the current scientific evidence does not support the hypothesis that MMR or any combination of vaccines cause the development of autism. Initial case series reports have not been substantiated by more focused reviews or by more in-depth follow-up research. It should be pointed out that factors known to be associated with autism include genetic factors and events that occur before birth. CDC recognizes how important it is to identify the causes of autism, as well as to ensure the safety of vaccines. CDC is currently undertaking 3 studies related to autism or about hypotheses related to vaccines and autism. First, CDC is using its autism surveillance program in Atlanta to examine the possibility of a link between the MMR vaccine and autism. Second, we are working with the National Institutes of Health to conduct a study that will evaluate whether vaccination is linked with developmental regression, which occurs in some children with autism. Third, CDC is using the vaccine safety data link in collaboration with several HMOs to study inflammatory bowel disease and the MMR vaccination. Through these studies, we hope CDC is working to assure the safety of the vaccination program and to identify preventable causes of autism. Mr. Chairman, in the past 4 years, public health has made significant advances in preventing developmental disabilities. Prevention of congenital syphilis and congenital rubella syndrome have spared the lives and prevented disability for thousands of children. Newborn screening programs have prevented lifelong mental retardation in children with hyperthyroidism and sickle cell disease. However, given these strides, we still don't know what causes many developmental disabilities, including autism. While additional scientific research is being completed, it's important to also consider the broader context of public health, including the vaccination program, which is one of the most successful public health achievements of the 20th century. Given the weight of the scientific data and the known seriousness and ongoing risk of vaccine-preventable diseases, in CDC's judgment, the best public policy is to continue vaccination unchanged while aggressively working to try to identify causes of developmental disabilities. CDC urges the community and the parents who have testified today that agrees with the committee and the parents who have testified today that autism has a significant and a profound adverse impact on the lives of children and families and communities where it occurs. We must track this disorder. We must identify the preventable causes. We must institute effective prevention programs. It is my hope that our efforts, combined with those of NIH and the academic community, will lead to a way to prevent developmental disabilities of autism, enabling those children to lead full and productive lives. Thank you, Mr. Chairman and members of the committee.
Thank you, Dr. Boyle. Dr. Offit.
Yep. First, I'd like to recognize the courage of the parents who've testified here today, as well as the 2 grandparents on the committee, including you, Mr. Chairman. As I share my testimony, I also deeply share their feelings and concerns. My name is Paul Offit. I'm a pediatrician. I'm also the chief of infectious diseases and the Henley Professor of Immunologic and Infectious Diseases at the Children's Hospital of Philadelphia and the University of Pennsylvania School of Medicine. In addition, I'm a member of the Advisory Committee on Immunization Practices to the CDC. I have 20 years of experience in the areas of virology and immunology. My role in these proceedings is to explore the theories that have arisen due to concerns by the public that autism might be caused by the combination of measles, mumps, and rubella vaccines, known as MMR. No evidence exists that proves this association. However, 3 theories have been used to explain it. In the time that I've been given, I'd like to explain why I think that these theories are not valid. The first theory is that children who get the measles vaccine make an immune response not only to the vaccine, but also to their own nervous system. This kind of reaction is called autoimmunity. To understand why this theory is invalid, we must first understand differences between natural measles infection and measles vaccination. During natural measles infection, the measles virus reproduces itself many times in the body and causes disease. In contrast, following measles vaccination, the vaccine virus reproduces itself much less and doesn't cause disease. Because more measles proteins are made during natural infection than after immunization, the immune response to natural infection is greater than the immune response to immunization. If the immune response is greater after natural infection, then the autoimmune response would also be greater. If this were the case, then autoimmunity should occur more frequently after natural infection than after vaccination. Or said another way, if measles virus cause autism, then measles vaccination would lower, not raise, the incidence of autism. The second theory is that the child's immune system is simply overwhelmed by seeing three viruses in a vaccine at the same time. Some have gone so far as to suggest that it may be of benefit to divide the MMR vaccine into three separate vaccines. The rationale behind this theory is that children do not normally encounter such an assault on their immune system. From the birth canal and beyond, infants are confronted by a host of different challenges to their immune system. Their intestines encounter foreign proteins in milk and formula. Their lungs encounter bacteria inhaled on the surface of dust in the air. And literally thousands of different bacteria immediately start to live on the skin, as well as the lining of the nose, throat, and intestines. Here is how infants deal with this immediate confrontation to their immune system. Babies have a tremendous capacity to respond to their environment from the minute they're born. The newborn has billions of immunologic cells that are capable of responding to millions of different microorganisms. By quickly making an immune response to bacteria that live on the surface of their intestines, babies keep these bacteria from invading their bloodstream and causing serious disease. Therefore, the combination of the three vaccines contained in MMR, or even the 10 vaccines given in the first 2 years of life, is literally a raindrop in the ocean of what infants successfully encounter in their environment every day. The third theory is that the MMR vaccine is given by an unnatural route. The rationale behind this theory is that children do not normally encounter viruses or bacteria under their skin or in their muscles. But infants and children frequently encounter viruses and bacteria in many places throughout the body. Our species survives because from the minute we are born, we are capable of meeting challenges at all sites. To review, here are the medical facts. First, if autism is a consequence of autoimmunity, then the incidence of autism would have decreased, not increased, after vaccination. Second, children from birth are confronted with and manage an enormous array of different challenges to their immune system at the same time. Third, challenges to their immune system occur by a variety of routes. The parents we've heard testifying here today are asking a scientific question. Does the MMR vaccine cause autism? Questions of science are best answered by scientific studies. And the answer to this question is already available. Dr. Brent Taylor and his co-workers in London have conducted a large, meticulously designed, well-controlled study that disproved an association between MMR vaccine and autism. I believe other studies will confirm Dr. Taylor's results because it's important to have confirmatory studies. What's at stake here? In the early 1990s, our immunization rates against measles dropped only about 10%. Measles outbreaks swept across the country. About 11,000 people were hospitalized and 123 died from measles, died from a disease that is easily and safely prevented by a vaccine. My concern, Mr. Chairman, is that parents listening to or reading about this hearing might incorrectly conclude that vaccines cause autism. This is not the case. Vaccines are extremely safe and highly effective. I encourage this committee to make that fact clear to every parent in America. If, as a result of reading about this hearing, some parents choose to withhold or delay vaccines for their children, their tragedy could be profound. If many parents choose to withhold vaccines, the tragedy all across America could be devastating. Let's proceed cautiously, carefully, and scientifically. Thank you.
Dr. Taylor.
Hello. I'm Brent Taylor. I'm the Professor of Community Child Health at the Royal Free and University College School of Medicine and the Head of Department of Pediatrics and Child Health on the Royal Free Campus of University College London. I'm honored to have the opportunity to testify today. I'm here as a clinical scientist, but I'm also a practicing pediatrician. My clinical work involves children with disabilities, including autism. I know how desperate families can be to understand the cause of their child's often devastating condition. I also know that if we are to avoid families being led astray by false hopes, that advances in understanding and treatment must be based on high quality and rigorous science. Mr. Wakefield and Professor O'Leary's testimony notwithstanding, the belief that MMR is the cause of autism is a false hope. I have four main points. We do not fully understand the reasons why autism has recently increased. We do know that there is no evidence that immunizations are involved. Secondly, there is no evidence that MMR vaccine causes autism. Thirdly, there is no conspiracy to suppress information about the side effects of vaccines, completely the reverse. Fourthly, because of poor science, uptake of MMR vaccine has fallen to dangerously low levels in the United Kingdom, putting children's lives at risk from a resurgence of the damaging and occasionally killing but preventable diseases, measles, mumps, and rubella. The same thing could happen in the United States of America. If we could have the first overhead, please. Here are some figures from the United Kingdom. You can see at the top in the black closed circles, MMR uptake, which has fallen from about 90% in 1995 to 75% in April 1999. There's almost an exact parallel fall, that's the open circles, in mothers' confidence in the safety of MMR vaccine. Can we have the next overhead on top of this one, please? The reason for this loss of confidence mainly relates to two papers produced by Mr. Wakefield and colleagues. The first, which incorrectly related measles vaccine to Crohn's disease, one form of inflammatory bowel disease, has subsequently been completely undermined. There is no evidence that measles or measles vaccine plays any part in inflammatory bowel disease. The second arrow shows the timing of a paper produced by Mr. Wakefield describing a small group of inadequately described children with a range of autism-related disorders. Following each of these papers, there was a major effect on mothers' confidence and a resultant further decline in MMR uptake. I'll now discuss the results of an epidemiological study I led to test Mr. Wakefield's hypothesis that MMR causes autism. My two senior colleagues, Dr. Elizabeth Miller and Dr. Paddy Farringdon, have submitted testimony to this committee with details of our methods and the background to our study. We identified all known cases of autism, 498 in total, living in a defined area of North London, and compared details of the onset and recognition of their condition with independently collected data on exactly when they received MMR and other measles-containing vaccines. The study involved a large amount of work, and we analyzed the data in considerable depth. There are lots of results which have been published in The Lancet. In summary, all our analyses were negative. We concluded that MMR vaccine is not causally related to autism. In particular, we looked for clustering after MMR of regression where it occurred, the timing of parents' concern about the child's development, and the age at diagnosis. There were no significant relationships. Our results are supported by other studies from Sweden, from Finland, and from France. Of particular interest to this hearing is the rise with time in the cases we identified from the late 1970s to 1992. Could we have the next overhead, please? Mr. Wakefield has compared our results with those reported in California. This is the overhead. It's important to remember that the authors of the California report clearly stated that theirs was not incidence data. The overhead, which is downloaded from the Lancet webpage, is of rather poor quality, and so is Mr. Wakefield's content. He has fiddled with the data regarding the dates of the introduction of autism, and to demonstrate other problems he has with time relationships, it's worthwhile just looking at the bottom line, where it goes from 1987 to 1960 to 1990. What is actually going on? I've included two additional arrows. They're the red arrows, which perhaps more accurately identifies the acceleration in cases in the rates at which autism is increasing. These, one can see, occurred at least 2 years before autism was introduced into the United Kingdom and at least 2 years after in California. Hardly a convincing causal relationship. There's another problem for the MMR theory. Could we have the next overhead, please? Here's our data from our study up until 1992, which is what we published. The rise in autism can be seen there as clearly occurring long before MMR was introduced. And I must say that contrary to what Mr. Wakefield and some of the groups he's associated with say, we included all cases in our analysis, including those involved in the MMR catch-up campaign. After 1992, if you could just remove that bit, please. Numbers fell. We didn't include these data in our analysis because we felt that there might be too many missing cases not yet diagnosed. And by leaving the left-hand side, it really gave the hypothesis that MMR causes autism the best chance of being confirmed. The parallel line in red is data from two of the larger districts, and it's important because we have preliminary data as a part of a further study on the same population to see what's happened. Is autism still going up, or is it flattening out? What our early results in these two districts show, and if you could have the final overhead, is that rates are going down. There is an overall increase in numbers reflecting continuing better recognition of autism and immigration. A fall is seen in both studies suggesting it's a real fall. Cases appear in this population to have peaked about 1992 for reasons that are quite unclear. This finding alone must exclude MMR as a cause of autism. MMR had a rapid uptake in our population from 1988, then rates plateaued, certainly until 1995, while autism rates were rising and then falling. We need more research on autism and its treatment. But, Mr. Chairman and members of the committee, present evidence does not support a causal relationship between MMR vaccine and autism. As a result of adverse publicity on this topic, many clients in the UK are now at risk from the dangerous diseases, measles, mumps, and rubella. I urge this committee to strongly support the continued MMR program to avoid putting American children's lives at risk. As a result of my work and close study of the evidence on this topic, I believe I can say with confidence, MMR vaccine is not the cause of autism.
I want to thank the panel. We'll now go to our questions. Dr. Offit,
yes.
Henry, you want to run the committee. You get the majority. Don't say anything more to her today. Leave her alone. I don't care. Leave her alone. I'll tell her. Well, we're going to go 5 minutes. Just leave her alone.
Dr. Offit, you talk about collaboration, I guess, with the Merck pharmaceutical company.
Yeah, I disclosed in my written report, I've been in collaboration with Merck and Company on the development of a rotavirus vaccine since 1992.
Do you do any traveling around speaking on behalf of Merck or Merck products?
I travel and speak about vaccines, and that the those talks are supported by unrestricted educational grants from either pharmaceutical companies or from universities.
So they pay for your expenses, that sort of thing?
They have an interest in educating physicians about vaccines, and, okay. and it's and, good and that they do, because physicians need to be educated about vaccines.
I understand, and they produce the MMR vaccine, don't they?
Yes, they do, yes.
Thank you. Dr. Taylor, in your Lancet paper, you omitted to mention the catch-up campaign, that is the vaccination of children over 1 year of age when the vaccine was introduced. Yet you appear to have included these catch-up children in your analysis of the step-up hypothesis. Do you consider that to be do you think that's the correct analysis?
That statement isn't true, Mr. Chairman. We did include the children involved in the catch-up campaign in our analysis, as is clearly stated. To suggest otherwise, and I suspect the suggestion comes from Mr. Wakefield, is malicious.
Well, was it not omitted in the original paper that you submitted?
No, all cases were included who received MMR vaccine. All cases, we also did additional analysis with all cases who received any measles-containing vaccine.
Didn't some of those 36 children receive the MMR vaccine after the...
I think what you're referring to is the reply which we put to Mr. Wakefield's criticism of our paper in The Lancet. And I have to say that his is the only critical scientific paper, the only criticism of our paper which we've received on a scientific basis. All other reports have been constructive and supportive. What we looked for there was the children who had received MMR vaccine, which we had included in our analysis. There were 36 such children. 29 of them, there was evidence regarding when the parents became concerned about their child's development. In all cases, this was before they received the MMR vaccine.
We have an epidemiologist in the audience, and where is he? Would you mind coming up? I'd like to have you sworn in real quickly. Do you swear to tell the whole truth, nothing but the truth, so help you God? Thank you. Can you explain the importance of properly counting these children born before 1988 who were given the catch-up vaccines?
Well, as implied by Professor...
Point of order, if you'll suspend your answer to that question. I want to make a point of order.
You, gentlemen, will state his point of order.
The rules of this committee require that we be given witnesses appearing before the committee shall, so far as practicable, submit written statements at least 24 hours before their appearance, and when appearance in a non-governmental capacity, provide a curriculum vitae and listing of any federal government grants and contracts received in the previous fiscal year. The witnesses, identification of witnesses are to be provided to members of the committee. Suddenly, we have a witness being called forward. The rule two says every member of the committee or the appropriate subcommittee, unless prevented by unusual circumstances, shall be provided with a memorandum at least 3 calendar days before each meeting or hearing explaining, one, the purpose of the meeting or the hearing, the names, titles, background, and reasons for appearance of any witness. The ranking minority member shall be responsible for providing the same information on witnesses whom the minority request. Suddenly we have a witness being called forward. We have all of these people to testify. And we have now a witness come. I don't know who he is. It just seems to me that this is in violation of the rules.
I think as you were reading there, that where there's unusual circumstances, and I believe you can go back and read that again, or whenever practicable, was another term that was used in there. And so the chair, excuse me, we'll suspend for one moment.
Indeed. More water, please. Chairman, if I might be heard, and I'm going to withdraw my point of order. But I do want to say that there are procedures for the conduct of hearings which provide for opportunities for all points of view to be expressed and for a witness to be brought out of the audience because the witnesses before you didn't give you testimony that fit with your preconceived theory seems to me could turn a congressional hearing more into a circus than a genuine fact-finding opportunity. But I won't object if you want to call this witness. I do want to also point out that we have rules on the time that are allocated to members, and I would insist that that time be observed, or that all members be given the same open-endedness that that I see about to come in your questioning, because the clock that usually keeps time for our questioning has been deliberately stopped. I will not object, but I do think it is inconsistent with the rules of this committee to bring witnesses out of the audience when you have a panel here that just testified to whom we ought to pursue our questions, with whom we ought to pursue our questions.
The parliamentarian has just informed me that where there are extenuating circumstances, that the chair has the ability to bring a witness forward. And this is not the first time this has happened. That's the first thing. The second thing is, this is one of the most important hearings I think we've had, because we're talking about an epidemic of autism that's taking place in this country. And if there is information that's being given to the committee that's going to be in the congressional record that is not accurate, it needs to be corrected as quickly as possible, so that the American people and people from around the world who may want to look at the record of this committee have the facts. Now, if we have an epidemiologist here who has expertise about a report and can incite that information about this report where there might be an error, then we ought to correct it right now instead of waiting until a report is filed, goes out to the American people, and then try to correct it where there might be a misunderstanding.
Well, we do have an epidemiologist on this panel, and perhaps he ought to question her, or this other witness should have been asked to testify. No one would have objected to having anybody who had anything pertinent to say to us have an opportunity to present what they have to say. Yeah. Mr. Chairman, let's proceed, and let's keep the rules on time, or acknowledge the open-endedness of questions, because we'll have a lot of questions as well.
Dr. Spicer.
Very briefly, Congressman Waxman, your points are well taken and I respect them. I will say now to Professor Taylor that those additional cases in the catch-up campaign may well have been included in the paper, but were not clearly segregated or identified or enabled peers to evaluate the possible impact of including them or not. So the findings may have been misleading until we reanalyze them, taking that into account. Moreover, the use of the case series strategy of analysis is unconventional, not accepted by mainstream, and leaves the paper at best as a hypothesis generating study, and not something with which he or anyone can categorically say this proves that there is no relationship. It just shows and emphasizes what he said himself, is that we need to study it further. So we have a compelling reason to have a blue panel, international panel, to go back to that database, look at the raw data, and be able to come up with a second assessment that's verifiable by the scientific community and the relevant community. Thank you, Mr. Waxman.
Thank you very much.
Can I
point
of
order,
Mr. Chairman? Can I comment on that?
Stop the clock. Gentleman will state his point of order.
Is Mr. Taylor going to be given an opportunity to
comment
respond
on that?
At this point in time? I think it might be helpful to those of us who was sort of surprised by this new witness. I'd like to hear what Mr. Taylor has to say in response to that. I think it would be educational.
I have no objection to him responding, but I have some more questions of Dr. Wakefield.
Mr. Chairman, my point of order is, can we have it nearer in time to each other so we get the full benefit of it rather than go back and forth?
Next. He can have the time next, or Mr. Waxman can, and he can yield to Dr. Taylor. Dr. Wakefield, would you come back up, please? Dr. Wakefield, would you kind of clarify the difference of opinion that you have from your colleague?
My anxiety, Mr. Chairman, is that if you test a step-up hypothesis, that is, those children who should be the first to receive the vaccine at the age of 1 year, born in 1987, because the vaccine was introduced in the UK in 88, therefore they would have been 1 year old, then the takeoff, if there was a relationship between MMR and the vaccine, should have occurred at that point. The paper illustrated the point that the takeoff occurred before those born in 85 and 86. Now, if you had, what took place when the MMR was introduced was the catch-up campaign where all children of 1 to 4 years of age were targeted. It was an aggressive campaign. I know that because one of the editor, one of the authors on the paper that we published in The Lancet was in charge of that campaign for Hackney in northeast London. That if you give the vaccine to children over the age of 2, then it will cause the takeoff to occur before 1987, and that's exactly what occurred. Now, at the very least, those cases should have been mentioned, because the reviewers, in the absence of those data, cannot give a valid interpretation of the paper when they make a recommendation for it to be published or not. And they should have been excluded from the analysis so we could see how the graph looked without them. And that did not occur. And that is a major anxiety.
Dr. Taylor, you want to respond now?
Well, it does seem slightly surprising that at one moment we're accused of excluding them, and therefore that upsets the results, and now we're accused of including them, and that upsets the results. I have to say, the time relationships, the step-up part of our paper is the least important part of our findings. The direct findings, the time series analysis, is much more important, which is the direct evidence that the individual children did not develop symptoms of autism within various defined periods after they received the MMR vaccine. If I could just comment on Dr. Spicer's comment, again, he describes our analysis as unorthodox. I mean, we use the highest standards of epidemiological and statistical analysis in our handling of this data, and this data has been reviewed by numerous experts both prior to publication and since. Last week, our research was the basis of a detailed debate at the Royal Statistical Society where there was no criticism of the statistical techniques that were used, and the conclusions of our paper were accepted by this very expert group. The testimony which you've received from Dr. Elizabeth Miller, who's an epidemiologist, and Dr. Patty Farrington, who's an expert statistician, is tabled for the committee's consideration.
Would you mind, since there is this strong difference of opinion between you and Dr. Wakefield and I presume some others, would you mind providing the data for your study to the committee, the complete data?
I'll have to take advice on that from both my colleagues and the others. I would be required to decide whether the committee is an appropriate body for this information, which was collected, as you know, for the Medicine Control Agency, which is a branch of the Department of Health in the UK.
Well,
in principle, I have no problem, but in practice, I would need to check.
Well, we would be very happy to write to the Department of Health in the UK and ask that you be able to release that information to the committee in total, so that we could have somebody who's totally non-biased on this issue, hopefully.
Yes,
to analyze it.
I think it would need to be done by more than a selected statistician. I think it should be done. If it is to be reanalyzed, it should be reanalyzed by independent individuals, which of course is the problem in much of Mr. Wakefield's research, that it has never been independently verified. No one anywhere in the world has been able to reproduce any of his studies, and it seems possible that it's only going to be a matter of time before this most recent information is also
found. Well, my time has expired, but let me just say I believe that Dr. Wakefield and Professor O'Leary and others would be willing to give us the documentation and the study that they did, and we'd like to have yours as well so we can look at all of that. Mr. Waxman.
Mr. Chairman, because I believe autism is such a serious problem, I'm troubled by this hearing. This hearing was called and structured to establish a point of view, as the point of view of the chairman. The chairman believes a particular point of view, and that's the connection between autism and vaccinations. And you can look at it by the first panel, where we had five parents, all of whom believed the same thing that the chairman believed. And the way we just had the handling of the questions a minute ago. What also bothered me is when we asked that we have the American Medical Association or the American Public Health Association or the National Network for Immunization Information or the former Secretary of HHS, Dr. Louis Sullivan, real experts in addition to those we had before us, we were told, no, they can't fit in. I think hearings like this have a real danger, because if you sensationalize the idea that there's a connection between immunism and autism, immunization rates will drop. That's what happened in Great Britain after Dr. Wakefield published his first study, and immunizations dropped. Autism rates didn't drop, but measles rates increased. I was impressed by the statement that if we had a drop of just 10% in measles immunizations in 1990, and then we had 11,000 people who were hospitalized from measles. This can cause brain retardation and death. We know we can prevent that. Why should we then scare people about immunizations until we know the facts? And I fear that what we have in this hearing is a sensationalization by the chairman in order to get all these cameras to report to the American people that there is this connection, because he believes it and many other people believe it, and therefore a lot of others who watch this will think, well, I won't immunize my children. Dr. Wakefield came out with a report in England, and the first group to examine his claims was the Medical Research Council, which is the British equivalent to the NIH. And they found no evidence to indicate any link between the MMR vaccine and bowel disease and autism. After they did their work, the chief medical officer of the United Kingdom issued a letter to doctors in 1998 stating, based on the previous material that I have seen and on the opinion of experts present at the Medical Research Council, I have concluded there's no link between measles vaccine or MMR immunization, etc. And then the World Health Organization looked at his study, and they came up with a statement that said, given our view that previous scientific claims made by Dr. Wakefield and colleagues lack scientific credibility, that his present study does not meet the requirements for establishing such a causal relationship. I don't know whether that's true or not, but that's what the scientists in England said when they evaluated, as did Dr. Taylor when he evaluated Dr. Wakefield's study. Now, Dr. Wakefield's testified he's got some new information. Fine, let's get the new information out there. Let's let the epidemiologists evaluate it. Let's let scientists explore where the truth may be. But to put this out in a congressional hearing and to scare people from getting immunizations, we know that without immunizations, dreaded diseases will occur. Deaths and mental retardation and disability will occur among our children, and we could prevent it. What we don't know, and we have a lot of information to the contrary, is that autism will result from that immunization. Dr. Taylor, well, let me ask Dr. Boyle, you're an epidemiologist. Suddenly we had to pull out of the audience an epidemiologist. You are an epidemiologist. What do you have to say about this debate we're seeing back and forth? Have you evaluated any of this information that's now being presented as if it were fact?
I think that the scientific data currently does not show an association between the MR vaccine and autism. We've heard from Dr. Taylor. We also know that there is a study in Sweden by Dr. Gilberg and Associates, who has been monitoring, it's only the only country actually that's been monitoring the rate of autism over time, and they looked at pre-MMR immunizations and post-MMR immunizations and found no changes in the rates of autism.
Well, I can't tell you what's true or not, but I don't think our chairman can tell you what's true or not either, and I feel it's, when we had this hearings on whether there was campaign abuses by Democrats, a lot of people's reputations were ruined, and I thought the hearings were unfair, but those were political. the consequence of an unfair hearing on autism connected to vaccinations can cause people to die. And I worry about that, and I think we ought to get the facts before we make the assertions, and not make the assertions and then throw out the witnesses who tell us information that doesn't fit those allegations. Yield back.
Gentleman's time has expired. Does the gentlelady from Florida?
Thank you so much, Mr. Chairman, and I thank you for holding this hearing rather than have some questions, because I'm needed for a caucus in my other subcommittee. I wanted to thank you, Mr. Chairman, for the importance of this hearing and for highlighting the need for further research as we explore the possible causes, intervention strategies, counseling, and other services to help families who are living with autism. We need to keep in mind that a person with autism is indeed a person first and not a behavior. And these posters that I would like to have the audience and the panelists see are of constituents of my congressional district, Bonnie and Willis Flick, two beautiful children in my district who are living with autism, and indeed the whole family lives with autism. Bonnie and Willis are fortunate to afford treatment and therapy, but so many other families are not as fortunate. And I thank you for the opportunity to hear from researchers and from parents and people who cope daily with this disease. And I commend you for your initiative, Mr. Chairman, in seeking answers to help those individuals with autism and for the opportunity to learn from experts and researchers. And I especially want to thank you for allowing Dr. Kathy Pratt, the director of the Indiana Resource Center for Autism, for allowing her to come to share her expertise on what we as policymakers can do to help families dealing with autism. Approximately 50% of Florida's children with autism reside in my community in South Florida, and I'm delighted to have you take this leadership role, Mr. Chairman, and have your committee address this issue so that one day we can find prevention and methods and a cure to help us all cope with this rising curse of autism. I thank you very much, Mr. Chairman.
The gentlelady yield to me. Let me just ask Dr. Wakefield, because I want to get through this panel and get on. Would you be willing to give us all of the information on your study so it could be reviewed?
Certainly.
You will?
Yes.
Thank you very much. Professor O'Leary, would you be willing to give us all the information on your study so we can review it?
Yes, sir. No problem.
I can't hear you.
Yes, sir.
Okay. Dr. Singh, would you be willing to give us all the information on your study so we can review it thoroughly?
Yes, absolutely, without any hesitation. Mr. Chairman, if there is a moment, if I may have a chance, I would like to raise some interesting point later on.
Just one second.
Yeah, thank you very much.
Now then, Dr. Taylor, would you give us all the information on your study so we can review it along with the others?
In principle, I have no problem, but I would need to discuss that with my employing authority, University College London, and with the Department of Health who funded this study.
Who funded your study, Dr. Wakefield?
We did. We have a small charitable contribution, but...
charitable organization.
We found it a little difficult to get funded.
And yours was done by the government?
It was funded by the Medicine Control Agency, which is a body charged with responsibility for the safety of vaccines and other treatments.
Well, I would be happy to work with the ranking Democrat, Mr. Waxman, to get an independent group of doctors, scientists that we mutually agree upon to review all of your work to come to some kind of a conclusion if it's possible. And so since Dr. Wakefield and Professor O'Leary and Dr. Singh have all agreed, we'd sure like to have yours, and I'll be happy to write a letter, as I said before, to the authorities in England asking for your report, and hopefully we'll get that along with the others so we can review them side by side.
Chairman, just on that point,
because
I want to agree with you.
Sure. Mr. Waxman.
I drafted a letter, and I'm going to share it with you, and I hope you'll join with me on this letter to Secretary Shalala. And we say in this letter, because of the vital public health importance of childhood immunization, as well as the growing concerns over the prevalence of autism in the United States, we urge you to convene under the auspices of the National Institutes of Health, the Centers for Disease Control and Prevention, and the Food and Drug Administration, an expert panel of leading scientists and clinicians to review whether there is any causal
association between vaccines and autism, given the grave possibility that immunizations against life-threatening childhood diseases may decline as a result of unsubstantiated allegation of vaccine-induced autism, I would want her to act as expeditiously as possible. Perhaps you'll join me in this letter, because I think the only proper thing to do is to get the experts to evaluate all these conflicting claims, because I wouldn't want the American people, as a result of this hearing, to stop being immunized if these claims are not...
Let me reclaim my time and say, nor would I, but one of the concerns, the time is right here, it's on the clock. But let me just say that the Department of Health and Human Services and Donna Shalala and the others have some very competent people over there. We have been checking into all the financial records of the people at the FDA, HHS, and CDC, and we're finding some of those people, and even on the advisory panels, do have some possible financial conflicts, as was expressed in the New England Journal of Medicine just recently on their front page. And as a result, I will join with you to get an independent panel to review all of these studies, but I want to make sure they're not controlled by the health agencies of this country that may have some people that have some possible conflicts of interest. And it's already been expressed in the New England Journal of Medicine, and we believe that also possibly exists with some of the agencies of our health services here in the United States. And so I will join with you, and we'll pick them together, and we'll try to make sure we have some people that are totally unbiased.
Well, independent means no conflict of interest. And I wouldn't want a panel that had people with a conflict of interest, but I do want a panel of experts, and I think that the NIH and the CDC and the FDA can give us a panel that can do this evaluation.
Well, so
why some people find that amusing, but
well, so long as we find there's no conflict of interest, we wouldn't have any problem with that. Mr. Tierney.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. I have to say that I'm a bit disturbed with the nature of this hearing and the direction it's gone, and only because I have a considerable number of people in my district who have not only children experiencing autism, and they deal with it every day, but we have a number of institutions that have been working hard to give people the kind of support that they need to deal with this situation. And I find this hearing taking on a lot different tone, other than a hearing that would like to look at some solutions and work together in a cooperative way to find out just what we can do. I do note that Representative Michael Bilirakis from Florida has some legislation filed. One of the provisions would authorize funding to the NIH to establish centers of excellence that would conduct basic and clinical research into the causes, diagnosis, detection, prevention, and treatment of autism. I congratulate the members of this panel that are co-sponsors on that legislation and hope that that's the direction in which we will proceed, because I think we need to find out what the causes are. First, Dr. Boyle, you're an epidemiologist. You know, lawyers have an easier word to say than you people go around doing that. But given your background, have you examined the evidence that autism is increasing in the United States?
We do know that the rates of autism appear to be higher than previously thought. And as I said in my testimony, they range from 10 to 15 per 10,000. But that's really from studies from other countries. We don't have, we had prevalence studies conducted in the United States. There were two done in the 80s, found very low rates, maybe methodologic reasons for that. At CDC, we've begun to develop a monitoring program at CDC. It's only for the Atlanta area. We have our first year of data collected. We're in the process of reviewing the information on the children with autism, and we hope to have a rate fairly soon. And we'd like to see some similar activities in many other locations. We have a wonderful model in birth defects. They're many years ahead of us in terms of trying to understand the causes of birth defects, and there's about 35 states that monitor birth defects on an ongoing basis. That doesn't happen for developmental disabilities. And we need to make that happen.
Right. There are people in my district, particularly in the Merrimack Valley area, who seem to have at least acknowledged an increase in the number of reported cases, if not of autism itself, of one of the other related diagnoses or whatever.
Okay.
Have you heard of or it's at least had
it's a difficult
evidence?
Issue because the diagnosis for autism has changed considerably. The first studies were based on these fairly narrow criteria from the way it was originally described. The more recent studies have actually used criteria that are much broader, and there's increased recognition. So we really don't know. There have been a number of investigators who've tried to see whether or not the increase in the rates over time, or the higher rates in more recent years, is really due to a real increase or this sort of redefinition and better awareness, and it's not an easy question.
Well, I bring that up only because in one instance, at least, a group of very active parents with children with autism worked with the school system and some other researchers and heightened the awareness of identification, and found a marked increase in the number of cases that were beginning to be identified in the area, as though people had not really appreciated these symptoms, including some doctors, mm-hmm. pediatricians who would look at it. That sound right to you?
Well, the one study that has addressed this is the study by Gilbert, which I mentioned earlier, was able to look at trends over time. And if you look at the range of functioning of those children over time, it appeared to be that the increase was in children who were higher functioning as well as children who were lower functioning. So the classic group seemed to remain constant. Now, why that's happening, you know, we don't know. That's what we hope to do the research to understand.
Well, I agree that we ought to do this research and do it soon. I'm a little bit concerned about what might be the message taken from this hearing by people, what we want to take on this. Dr. Boyle, if you had young children today, would you vaccinate them?
I do have children, and they are both fully vaccinated, and I would vaccinate them again.
Dr. Offit, how about you?
Yes, I have a 7-year-old son, Will, and a 5-year-old daughter, Emily, and they're both fully vaccinated.
And you do it again?
Of course. I want them to be protected against the viruses and bacteria that can cause serious disability and death. I'm fortunate, actually. I mean, I was a little boy in the 1950s, and when I was a little boy in the early 50s, there were 4 vaccines, diphtheria, pertussis, tetanus, and smallpox. I was fortunate that I wasn't killed by measles or paralyzed by polio. My son, hopefully, you know, didn't have to be as lucky, but, you know, hopefully as we move into the 21st century and can develop vaccines against respiratory syncytial virus and paraflu, children won't have to die from those diseases.
The way you wanted to add something.
I did want to mention one thing. You know, we do monitor the trend of other serious developmental disabilities in Atlanta. And just based on my own experience over the last 10 years or 15 years, we no longer see. We used to see children who were deaf due to congenital rubella.